privilege to be back here at the pulpit again after about, I guess, almost 3 months absence. Squirrels is having a hard time. So have I. Oh, it's relaxed though now and feel more like entering into the service again and expecting now to start this coming week, this coming Wednesday night for a revival right here in the tabernacle. And if God willing, I have kind of, Lord has promised me a different and new type of ministry. And if He pleased to do so, I hope to begin that new type of service this coming week here at the tabernacle for the first place. And then I have no scheduled meetings, but just Australia and New Zealand for this coming January. And then Brother Osborne is calling for a joint meeting that I kind of promised him here some time ago in Tulsa, but a little later on, but we're not sure of that yet. It was certainly good, Brother Jeffries, to get to shake your hand back here and also to hear your boy sing that song you played. I kind of like that father and son. Don't you like that? Bring up a child in the way that it should go. That's right, Mr. Ginther. You know that's right, both of you. Bring up a child in the way that it should go, and when he gets old, it'll not depart. And that's true. There may be sometimes that he may depart from it, but it won't depart from him. See? It'll always stay with him. That early training and whatever he's been brought up to do, it'll certainly stay with him. Now, I met Brother Jeffries out there, and I said, Brother Jeffries, I thought, you know, I'm always glad to see any of my visiting brethren in, but such a night for a visiting brother to come. This is the night of just the folks that come to the tabernacle, just prayer, this revival. This is the night we want to take tonight and tomorrow morning and tomorrow night just on what we believe here at the tabernacle. To rehearse it over again. We had some awful, odd beliefs. Very strange. But somehow or another, we find them in this Bible. They seem to be there all right. And now, if there would be a strange brother or sister in that belongs to a certain denomination or disagrees, just sitting in on this for tonight, we want you to know that you're perfectly welcome. See, you're just as welcome as you can be. But now, and we make this pretty rough, so if it seems that you don't agree with it, well now, you do that like I do when I'm eating cherry pie. And when I'm eating cherry pie, which is my favorite, I always, when I eat the pie, if I run into a seed, I don't throw the pie away. I just throw the seed away and just keep on eating pie. So, or like eating chicken. Now, all you all like chicken. See? And when you hit the bone, you don't quit. You just go around the bone and keep eating chicken. Well, that's what you do tonight while I'm saying here. You just, when you hit something, you say, now, I'm just sitting in this as a little church doctrines in these next three meetings. They're just kind of rehearsing what they believe and going over it. And the only way you can nearly make a person believe it is drive it home so hard till they'll have to know that that's the thing that's right. That's the only way you can make it stick. And it's like a friend of mine, Mr. Woods, I've been with. If you just drive a nail halfway in and the board's all loose, the wind will blow it down pretty soon. But you got to drive her in and make it stick hard. So now, if I just make this real rude on some of these places and to you visitors tonight that's sitting home, I'm not trying to throw you off. I'm just trying to drive home to this church what we believe. All understand that now real good, say amen. Amen. All right, that's okay. And I'll get this off my hands and then they're recording it and so forth, that later on, if they want to find out then what we really stand for and what the grounds that we stand on, these recordings will tell it. And then we do this ever so often, because there's new people comes in and we go ahead. And now, we won't be able to go over all the church doctrines, but just some of them, if we want to speak on. And now Wednesday night, oh, starts Monday and Tuesday, I'm going away to pray, get ready for healing service. And you can get on the phones or wherever you wish to and bring in anybody that you want to for this coming revival and tell them not to come in a hurry now. Not come say, well, now I'm going to run in and be prayed for tonight and tomorrow night's all good. You don't do that. You come in and listen a while. Because we want to take our time and lay that word out so close that the devil won't even have one little speck of room to ever move. And then when you let your faith run out to its end till you begin to believe, then let your subconscious go to acting, then the faith of God will back it up. Then you'll go right on out, see? Because your faith won't do too much. Your subconscious has to move in the direction that your faith is moving, and then God's faith moves in behind and confirms it all, see? But if it's your faith, oh yes, I got it right now, and even your subconscious rolling back here saying, I wonder if it'll work on me. It won't do it right then, see? So we want this to be a real healing service, and before I get anyone into the rooms and so forth for the healing or this new services, I want them to really understand what they're coming in there for. So, just remember and come and visit us, and we'd be glad to have you. Now remember, now in the morning, if we're going to continue on with the church doctrine, and tomorrow night, the same way. Now, you're welcome to come, and anybody can come. We're always glad to see anybody. But now this tonight is just directed home to the people that's of the tabernacle here that it's raised up in this doctrine. Or out in the fields, evangelistic fields, we just take the real fundamental evangelical doctrines of the Scriptures. But here at the tabernacle, we got our own thoughts and our own beliefs as a church. And that's what we're to go over tonight. And before we open His blessed Word, can't we just bow our heads for a moment of prayer? Almighty and powerful God, who before the world ever started whirling on the first Adam, You are God. You haven't changed a bit, and when there is no more Adams to hold it up and there's no more world to be held up, You'll still be God. You're for everlasting and from everlasting. Thou art God. You never had a beginning of days nor an ending of life. You'll always be. And Father, You being infinite and we finite, then we ask for Your divine mercy, God, realizing that this spirit of ours is to blend into the eternity, out of the time elements into eternity. Therefore, Lord, we're here to check up on our salvation, to see how we're standing in the sight of Thy Word, and to see how we are situated in our experiences. Are we living that which is pleasing to Thee? Does our spirit bear record with Your spirit? And does our teaching bear record with this Bible? And Father, may we examine both closely in these next three coming services. Grant it, Lord. Bless the pastor here, the deacons, the trustees, and all the laity, the people who come to this church. Since my days here, Lord, there's many, many, and I don't even know their names or where they come from, but I'm sure that You know all about them. And we're here for that one purpose tonight, Lord, to fellowship around the written Word. And give us the Holy Spirit in our lives, that we can step peacefully and soberly and in the fear of God and examine our lives by His Word. Grant it, Lord. And in this building tonight, Lord, there is my brethren of different phases of the church. And Lord, I'm so thankful that they are here to fellowship. Maybe we might disagree upon little principles of doctrines, but in that one great major principle, we're standing as united brethren in a front that, oh God, may it strengthen our fellowships and the bonds of God's grace and love rest upon us richly. Now realizing, Lord, that this is too much of a job for a man to do, because we have here under consideration tonight the destination of souls that's eternity bound. So we pray that the Holy Spirit will get right into the Word and will lay it out and explain it in His own way to us, the things that He would have us to know. Grant it, Lord, and when the times of service is over, may we go as a strengthened church, as a united together to put our hearts and our aims all together with our fellow citizens of the kingdom of God and move forward like never before. I want to thank you, Lord, here in the presence of the church and of the peoples that's here, that you gave me now several weeks of good rest. I feel wonderful tonight because of your presence and your blessings. Oh God, we pray for brother here, our brother that's going overseas, way down into those dark, dingy countries where his very life lays as a target. Oh Lord, bless our brother Jeffries as he goes, and his son and his wife, and give him great increase. May he cut holes through the darkness until the gospel light will shine far and wide. Hear us, Father, for we ask this petition in the name of the Lord Jesus, thy Son. Amen. Now tonight, reading in my small Scofield Bible, I've just passed 25 years old recently, and I can still read it, but it gets pretty dim. So I've got me a pair of reading glasses when I'm studying, and I'm going to see how it works tonight for my first time. Now, I have subjects like this that must the church... Oh, many things, if we can get to them. One of them, why are we called the church? Why are we not a denomination? Why do we believe in the eternal security of the soul of the believer? Why do we condemn women preachers? Why do we baptize by immersion? And will the church go through the tribulation? And many of those subjects here, I guess I got 15 or 18 of them for the next few nights. So I'm thinking tonight to begin with, to start with, it seems to be the Lord lays upon my heart just for this subject, the why are we not a denomination? The reason that now we have nothing against other peoples who are denominations. We have nothing against them, but I want to explain why that we never went in with any denomination. I was ordained in a little Baptist church, as you know, and the Baptist is not a denomination, wasn't until just recently, and now it's becoming just as much denomination as the rest of them. But the reason that we never become a denomination, now we are an organization. We are an organization recorded here in the courts as an organization, a group of people that's organized together to worship Christ, but we're not in a denomination. No one is going to dominate over us, you see. It's not a denomination, it's just an organization of fellowship amongst Christian believers. People come here to the church, and this becomes their home church if they wish to come as long as they live. And they can come here and disagree with everything that we preach. That's perfectly all right. You still, as long as you are a Christian, you've got fellowship and a handout just the same as the rest of them. See? If I said, I believe in baptizing by immersing by water, and you believed in sprinkling and stayed right on it, would still be just the same as we was if we both agreed. We might not be able to see eye to eye like, but as long as you are a Christian brother or sister, you're perfectly welcome. See, everybody. So we don't have any denominations, because I think that denominations separate brotherhood. Some of them say, well, we ain't got nothing to do in that revival. That's a Methodist revival. Well, that's Baptist. We're Methodist. We ain't got nothing to do with that. Brother, if Christ is in it, we got all to do with it. We got to put our... It's the body of Christ that is suffering. And I see that so much in the lands today. Now, Christ never did at any time ever organize any denominational church. Now, just let that be well assured. Now, I'm going to ask you tomorrow night, if any of these things you want to know, like some history that I'm quoting or something other, I don't have time just to drain that through and we'll get to another subject, because you can spend weeks on that very same subject. But if you want to know the place, anything, just ask me and lay it up here on the desk and I'll get it answered for you. Now, the oldest denomination and the first denomination church that we ever had is the Catholic Church. And it was organized 300 and something years after the death of the last apostle. And that's right. You get it in the early Nicene Fathers, and you get it in the writings of Josephus and all many of the great historians. See? And as far as in the any of the church ages down through until the death of the last apostle and 300 years the other side of the apostle, there was no denominational churches. And the Catholic was the first denominational church. And the Protestant church are the denominations who had pulled out of a denomination. The first Reformation come was Luther. After Luther comes Swingley. After Swingley comes Calvin, and just on down like that, and down to the Wesleyan Revival, and on down to Alexander Campbell, John Smith, and what more. See, on down to the last movements that we have up now is the different phases of the Pentecostal age. And I believe that God has dealt in each age. But did you ever notice that every time a church ever fails, and as soon as they denominate, they start failing right then? And whenever they fail, God never raises that church again. It goes right straight to seed. Now if you want to know the history on that, we can produce it, that there no church, not ever in the history of churches, has any denomination ever fell and ever rose again. Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Lutheran, whatever it may be, when they fell, they are gone. Now, that's right. Now, I told you now, put on the jackets, because we're going to make this stick. See? There has never, at one time, when a man come out as an individual and organized a church. It started, God deals with individuals, amen, not with denominations. God in no age ever dealt with a denomination. He's always dealt with an individual. In the Old Testament, He dealt with individual. In the New Testament, He dealt with individual. In any age, He's always dealt with individuals and not denominations. So therefore, if God isn't in the denomination, what's the use of me having anything to do with it as a denomination? Now, I'm not talking about the people in that denomination. I'm talking about the denomination itself. Because God's people's in all those denominations. Now, God never lets anything happen unless He gives a warning to it. I don't believe there's anything that... Now, like we have issues that comes out of the churches, such as we've had one recently about blood and oil and so forth, and you know the dear Brother Branham letter and so forth. But the reason that I stood against that, because it's not in the Word. And that's the reason that I'm against denomination, because it's not in the Word. And it has to have something we have to base our faith upon. And if we can't base it upon some denomination, we've got to base it up on God's Word. For that is the only foundation, is God's Word.
And then if God's word doesn't speak of a denomination, but speaks against the denomination, then we must speak with the word. Regardless of what bishop, what anyone says, what anyone thinks, what a good man says, what anything says, if it's not according to God's word, then it's wrong. See? It must be, the word must be the last thing. God's word must be the final amen. Now, remember, I'm not unchristianizing anyone. You understand that? In denominations, there's tens of thousands of precious souls in all those denominations who are God's children. But to separate them and segregate them, I'm against it. And God's word's against it. And I believe that there isn't an ism that's in the land today. There isn't an ism that's ever been in the land. But what? That it was foretold coming by God's word. I believe that God's word supplies everything that we have need of right here in the word. From our beginning to the end, it's found right in God's word. And then I believe that if it's in God's word, then we should, it foretells, and God's word is a warning. Now, you don't read God's word just like you read a newspaper. You read God's word by the Holy Spirit. See? Because the Holy Spirit itself speaking through Christ, Christ thanking God that he had hid these things from the eyes of the wise and prudent and would reveal them to babes such as would learn. So you see, there's no way of ever being educated. There's no way of ever denominating. There's only one way to get right, that's being led by the Spirit of God. And that experience you had must cope with this word. See? Then you got it. See? Like, when we get down here in a few minutes now, we're dealing with people who are some of them are radical Calvinists, some of them are radical Arminians, and different ways. Now, there's always, no matter how thin you slice it, it's got two sides to it. It's exactly right. And they both got arguing points, but the thing is, where lays the truth of it? That's where we're coming to. Where we think, by the grace of God, we show you the truth of it. Now, let's just take, and this is just where I got some of these church doctrines wrote out. Let's turn in your Bibles just a few minutes, all of you now. And let's get over to Revelation, the first chapter. Or the Revelation, the 17th chapter to start with. And let's just start reading and find out now where these churches began at and what started. Now, the Bible forewarns everything. It forewarns the days that we're living in. And now, Revelation's the 17th chapter, if you will. I said 13th. I didn't mean that. That's on the... We get that after a while, too. That's in the prophecy of the United States. But listen real close now. And there came unto me one of the seven angels which had the seven vials and talked with me, saying, come hither, and I will show thee the judgment of the great whore that setteth upon many waters. Now remember, this sounds mysterious. Now, this ill-famed woman. Now, if we're going to teach this, you've got to find out first what these symbols mean. Now, a woman in the Bible represents church. How many know that? That we are a bride. The church is a bride. Come here and I'll show you the judgment. Now, there's going to be a judgment spoke upon the great whore, the unclean woman, that sets upon many waters. Now, the woman symbolizing a church, and water symbolizes people. Now, if you'll notice it, also, look at the 15th verse while you're there. 15th verse of the same chapter. And he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the whore setteth are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. See? Now, this great church, great woman, now remember, she is an ill-famed woman. And if woman represents the church, and Christ's church is a bride, a holy bride, then here is an unholy woman. There would have to be an unholy pretended to be bride. as you do, she sets upon, or to be above means to have the governing over many waters. In other words, she's got power through all the nations and tongues and people. She's a great person, this woman is. Now, whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication. Kings of the earth have committed fornications. Rich man, great man. How would a king commit fornications with the church? It's spiritual fornication. Spiritual, what is fornication? It's like a woman living untrue to her husband. She's living with another man while she's got a husband. And this church then is pretending to be the bride of Christ while she's committing fornication with the kings of the world with her unclean living, unclean profession. Oh, it's deep and it's rich. I just love the word. Now, notice, whom the kings of the earth have committed fornications, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Her wine is what she was giving out, her stimulation. We are the church. We're the ones got it. See? I just draw that in your mind now. All right. So the angel told John, we'll show you this judgment is coming to this great church. Now what? So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman setting up on a scarlet colored beast. Scarlet in the Bible represents royal. The color scarlet means red. And beast represents power. Did you notice the beast come up out of the sea? That was in the Revelations the 13th. And when you see the beast coming up out of the seas, meant that this power was raising up among the people. But in Revelations 13, when this lamb came up, he came up out of the earth. No people, United States. But then after he had two little horns, civil and ecclesiastical powers, and then he received power and spoke like the dragon did before him. Well, you just got to mark it down. We are coming into a religious persecution with the same things that they did in pagan Rome many years ago. For it's thus saith the Lord. Now, watch it. Setting up on a beast of power. Did you notice Rebekah? When Eliezer found her, it was in the evening time, and she watered the camel. Because Eliezer said, if the damsel that comes and waters this camel, that will be the, and his midriff, that will be the one that you have chosen, Lord, to be the bride of your servant Isaac. And while he was yet in prayer, Rebekah come and draw water and give him a drink and water the camel. Notice, the camel was a beast, and that same beast that she was watering was the one who packed her to her bride, Isaac. And today the power of the Holy Ghost that the church is watering and worshiping is the thing that will pack it from this earth to meet the bride. Amen. Sure, Isaac was out in the field in the evening. We don't meet the Lord up in glory. Ephesians the 5th chapter says that we shall meet him in the air. Oh, that makes the Methodists get ready to shout. Think of it. See, the Lord Isaac had come out from his father's house and was out in the field when he saw Rebekah coming on the camel, and she loved him at first sight and jumped off the camel and run to meet him. That's right. That's where we meet the Lord. And the very camel that she watered packed her to her husband. Amen. And the very power that the church is worshiping, that the world's calling fanaticism, that the church is worshiping will be the same power that will take the church up in the air to meet the Lord in the air. The Holy Spirit, see? There is, and look, Rebekah was a virgin. And this woman is a prostitute we're speaking of here. Now, you get what the power is now? The power, what the means that the beast, she was on a scarlet. Now, what kind of a beast would it be? Scarlet? That would be a rich power. What kind of a church is this she's going to be now? She's a rich church. And she's a great church. And she's a powerful church. And she's influence sweeps the multitudes and people. And the kings of the earth have committed spiritual fornications with her. That's a great man of the earth. Now, we're going to find out who she is just in a minute and find out about these denominations. And the woman was arrayed in purple, kingly, arrayed in purple and scarlet colors, decked with gold and precious stones, pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of the abomination and filthiness of her fornication. What she have in her hand? Her doctrine. What she's holding out to the people. We are the church. We are this. And she's made the kings of the earth to come drunk with her like that. We are this. We're the great powers. We sweep every nation. We're the greatest church there is. Come on. Drink of water. Here, pour out a little bit of it. You take it. There it is. See? And she had in her hand a cup. Look. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet colors, decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of the abomination and filthiness of her fornication. Now, friends, we're not reading a daily newspaper. We're reading God's eternal and blessed Word. All heavens and earth will pass, but that Word will remain. That's right. And upon her head was written the name, was the name written, rather, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, the abomination of the earth. Now, here some time ago, I don't think in the church here, but I preached on the subject, handwriting on the wall, and give the historical standing of Babylon. Now, every ism that ever come up, every religion and every ism that there is in the world today began in Genesis. Now, if you get hostage to Babylon, you want to chase in the history, or some of those fine books, you can even find every ism that you want to find. I'm going to take you back there in a few minutes on women preachers, see, and show you just where it first started from, see, back in Genesis. And all these different things is how they come up out of Genesis. Genesis means the beginning. How many knows that that's right? Genesis is the beginning. So everything that is had to have a beginning. When I look at a tree, I've been in the woods for a couple trees, about 2 months. I see a tree, how pretty it is. I see it goes down. Another one comes up in its place. Perpetual life. And I think of that. But somewhere that tree had a beginning. It had to have a beginning. And the only way it could be designated to be a tree or to be an oak or a beech or a poplar or a palm or whatever it was, there had to be a master intelligence behind it. Or if it just wasn't been one oak tree, everything in the world would have been all oak trees. But something great, master intelligence, had to set it in order. Blessed be His holy name. He's the one who set the moon and the stars in the solar system. He set everything in its order. And He'll set His church in order. It'll turn just like He wants her to turn. East, west, north, or south, or whatever it is, when we can get these denominational ideas out of our mind and throw ourselves wholly into Calvary. You'll set it in order if we're just as submissive as the trees and His other creation. You never see the moon saying, "I ain't going to shine tonight. Some of you stars shine in my place." But we, we're different, you see. Now, Babylon. Watch how Babylon appears. It appears in the first of the Bible. It appears in the middle of the Bible. And it appears in the last of the Bible. Now, there's something. Now, it began with Nimrod. Nimrod founded Babylon and the Shinar Valley right close between the Tigris River and the Euphrates, and Euphrates passed through, and how that every road through all that country led straight to Babylon. And each one of those gates were about 200 feet across, those gates made out of brass. And when he got inside of the city of Babylon, every street led straight to the throne. Now you can go to Rome today, and every road will lead to Rome. And there's a little Virgin Mary standing on every corner, and a turn of the road with a Christ child in her hand, pointing that way towards Rome. See? It appears in the first of the Bible, it appears in the middle of the Bible, and here it is in the last of the Bible. Now, I just want to read on this for a few minutes so you get the background of this thing. All right. And I saw the woman, now watch the church. When you see woman, just think of church, see? I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints. Now, where does the word saint comes from? The word saint comes from sainted one or sanctified one. Sainted. All right. I saw her drunk with the blood of the saints. Now, if this woman is a church, she's persecuted the saints. And she's the greatest church. She has power all over the earth. She's over many waters, and she's the kings of the earth commit fornications with her. Well, who is she? Kind of a mystery. Now the spirits go to, you know, there's supposed to be 9 spiritual gifts in the church. To wisdom, and one to understanding, and one for healing, and one for so forth. And with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. Look like they didn't care much what Jesus said, it's what the church said. That's right. And that's correct, too. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. I wondered with admiration. There was a marvel thing about her. How did I wonder how did she... Now, let me take John's place and try to open that up a little bit, see? John says, there she sits. She's pretending to be a Christian church. She's got all the access to the monies of the world. She's got the kings of the earth at her feet. She's a rich and colorful thing. And how can she be drunk with the martyrs of Jesus? How can she persecute the saints? How can she kill those martyrs of Christ? And yet she's claiming to be a Christian herself, a Christian church. Now, watch. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carrieth her, and which had 7 heads and 10 horns. Now this is just common reading here. Now you catch this, this would be very easy. The beast which thou sawest was and is not, and shall descend out, ascend out of the bottomless pit, and shall go into perdition. And they that dwell upon the earth shall wonder, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they beheld the beast which was, which is not, and yet is. Now this has got to pinch. So here it is. He said, now notice that when all, not just a few, but all that dwell upon the earth shall wonder, all of them will wonder, the whole world will wonder about this woman, there's just one group that won't be wondering about it. And that's those who had their name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, I just might as well squeeze this in right here because we're going to get into it in a few minutes. See? When was their names put on the Lamb's Book of Life? From when the last revival they attended, the night they went to the altar, the night they joined the church. I'm not trying to hurt you, but I'm telling you the Bible said their names were put on the Lamb's Book of Life since the foundation of the world. Exactly. When God, in the beginning, saw that He had sent His Son, and He'd take a sinner's place, when God's Son's blood was shed, the Bible said his blood was shed before the foundation of the world. How many knows the Bible says that? That the blood of Christ was shed before the foundation of the world. When that blood was shed, every member of the body whose names was written with that blood on the Lamb's Book of Life at the foundation of the world. What you so scared about? Oh, brother. That unlocks the doors, doesn't it? Well, now let's just read this right here and see if what that says right, see? And the angel said unto me, wherefore does our beast lay first? And the beast which thou sawest, or that's it, the beast which thou sawest is and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Now we're coming back to that, but I want to get this other, because we're getting on it. And shall go into perdition, and they that dwell upon the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. There's going to be a bunch on the earth, in other words, that's going to be deceived. For he deceived them. And there was only one group that was not deceived. And that was the one that had their name on the book of life since the foundation of the world. We'll get into that a little later. Now, notice the woman, the church, she was mystery Babylon. We see her appear by Nimrod. What was Nimrod's purpose? Nimrod founded a city and caused all of the other cities to pay tribute to this city. Could we see such a thing today? Is there such a place today? Is there a church that has domination over every nation in the world? Certainly. Is there a place today that makes every nation pay tribute to it? Is there a place? Let's go ahead and read the rest of this just a little bit so you get the whole picture of it. All right. Which seen the beast which was, is not, and yet is. And here is the mind that has wisdom. Now, how many knows that wisdom is one of the gifts of the Spirit?
Amen.
Now, what kind of group is he talking to then? He must be talking to a group of people that has the gifts of the Spirit operating in this church. Here is to the mind that has wisdom. I used to find it all through these church ages here. Pulling out the Holy Spirit, speaking out how those gifts to be working in the last days. Now we've got gifts of healing working. Or it's going good. Well, brother, these other gifts, that's just one of them. That's just a little minor thing. Well, here's a far greater gift right here. What should be the best, the gift of the Holy Ghost of wisdom to put the Word of God together and to show the church where we're standing than just to get somebody healed? We all want to be well. But I'd rather have my soul well than my body well anytime. Oh, my. Here, the Holy Spirit speaking through John and Patrick said, here's to the wisdom. Let him listen to this. Now we're getting a picture drawn out here. Here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. There is only one city that I know of in the world. There's two cities that I know of that has seven or more mountains in it. Cincinnati is one of them, which is supposed to be the fiction story of Cincinnati, some other wolf, you know, that so forth. But it has more than that in it. But there's no one church dominates Cincinnati. There's only one place in the whole world that has a church sitting on seven hills that dominates the entire world. Now, I've just come from there. All those things. And I've seen there where it said, here's to wisdom, Revelation 13. Let him that has wisdom count the numbers of the beast. For it's the number of a man. Not a bunch of men, a group of men, but a man. And his number is 666. I've often heard that over the throne of the Pope of Rome, it's wrote vicarious affilia delia. I often wondered if that was true. Draw a line and draw it up in figures and Roman numerals and see if it is. It's exactly the truth. I stood that close to the triple crown of the Pope in a glass. Jurisdiction of hell, heaven, and purgatory. See? So those things have just come from there. Just come from Rome and know it's the truth. Now, we know it's pictured out. And here are the seven kings, five are fallen, which was at that time, and one is, that's one to come now, which was Caesar, and another is yet to come, which was Herod, which was wicked. Now watch how perfect it is. And when he cometh, he must continue for a short space. Does anybody know how long Herod reigned? 6 months. Pulled his mother through the street from the single tree of a horse and burnt the city and laid it onto the Christians and fiddled on the hillside while it was burning the city. 6 months is, see? And the beast, now watch, look what a rascal that he was. See? Now watch. And the beast that was and is not, even is the eighth. And is of the seventh, the nature of the seventh, and goeth into perdition. Anyone knows what perdition means? Hell. And watch where he sent it out of. Hell. What is it? The bottomless pits. There's no foundation for Catholic doctrine. There's no Bible for Catholic doctrine. There's no such a thing as any Bible for any Catholic doctrine. Not at all. They don't claim to be. The priest set up, this little priest up here in Sacred Heart Church, come over there. And he said, I was telling him about baptizing Mary Elizabeth Frazier. He said, oh, you baptized her according to the way the early Catholic Church baptized. I said, when did that? He said, in the Bible. Your Bible. I said, did the Catholic Church baptize that? Is that the teaching of the Catholic Church? Yeah, I said, in the infallibility of the Catholic Church, why has it changed so much? See? He said, well, see, you all believe the Bible, we believe the Church. See? We don't care what the Bible says, it's what the Church says. That's exactly right. You ever come to a showdown to try it once? See? We don't care what the Bible says, that has nothing to do with it. They care what the Church says. See? But we don't care what the Church says, we believe what God says. Amen. For the Bible is written, let every man's word be a lie and mine be the truth. That's why we're not denominations. Now watch. Listen to this just a minute. Five kings, which it was, fallen five kings, if you want that from the history, I'll show it to you. And one is the one to come. Now watch. The beast. Now the beast wasn't a king. He was one which is not, and yet he is, and is not. Yet he is, and he is not. What is it? Confession of the popes. A power, a beast. Amen. Ruling. That's when pagan Rome was converted to make papal Rome. Pagan Rome was converted, and then it became the papacy, which they had a pope instead of a king, and the pope is the spiritual king. That's the reason he's a crowned spiritual king, claims to be the vicar of Jesus Christ. There you are. Now notice, and we're going to bring that Catholic doctrine out there and show you how it's weeded right down into the Protestant churches. See? How she's still laying right in the Protestant church. A lot of it. Contrary exactly to the Bible. Absolutely contrary. Now, a beast which was, which is not. Now remember, all of them will be deceived upon the earth whose name is not written from the foundation of the world. That's the And the beast that was and is not the 11th verse, and yet is the 8th, and now the 7th, and goeth into perdition. He'll continue on until he hits the bottomless pits at the end of the road. And the 10 horns which thou saw are 10 kings. Now watch here. If you want to see something striking, watch this. Are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. They're not crowned kings, they're dictators. See, they never was crowned kings, but they receive power as kings 1 hour in the reign of the beast. That's just this little shadowing time right now where dictators are rising up. They receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Now, all right, these have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. Amen. Glory! For he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called the chosen condemnation of the world and abiding faithful in their calling. Yeah. Hallelujah. That's it. They are called the chosen and the faithful. And the conjunction. The chosen and faithful. They shall overcome him. No matter how great they get. And this great communism move we got today, don't worry about that. That's working exactly into the hands of God. I can prove it in this Bible. He's going to make her suffer for every martyr she ever killed. Yes, sir, you watch these kings all agree together and will hate her. And the whole nation, the whole world sweeping communism. Well, it's got to be a move of God to punish it. You say, wait a minute, Brother Branham, communism a move of God? Absolutely. It certainly is a move of God. The Bible says so.
Hallelujah.
But it's moving in to pronounce judgment upon ungodly and disgracefully illegitimate people. What's left in this world? What have we got? Here the other day, I'll stop on the subject just a minute if it's possible. I was reading in a piece of scripture where that an illegitimate child will not enter the congregation of the Lord for 14 generations. How many of those that? Right. Jerome 23. An illegitimate child, if a woman is caught in the field, that's away from protection of man, and a man overcomes that woman, that man will have to marry her, and regardless if she becomes a prostitute, he has to live with her till he dies. And if this woman marries him, pertaining that she is a virgin, and she isn't, then she can be killed for it. And if a man and a woman which are married, and they bring forth an illegitimate child, that the congregation of the Lord, he'll not enter to 14 generations, and 40 years as a generation will be 400 years before that sin ever gets out of Israel. God hates sin! How do you expect to wait on the holy blood of the Lord Jesus just because you belong to a certain denomination, expect to go, and you're going to come God's grounds or you're not coming at all? Right. Deacon, preacher, whatever we may be, has nothing to do with it. Amen. You come on God's terms. 14 generations. The person that's sitting present now, who is discussing that with me, said, how do we know who would ever be saved then? I said, that's where you ought to be a good Calvinist. Your name was put in the book before the foundation of the world. God takes that bloodstream. That's up to him. Well, what's that got? Listen, you young people today, I don't know where you come to this church or where you come. You young boys and girls, did you realize the things that you're doing, if there is another generation, your children will be judged for what you do? Haven't you no respect of decency? You girls that's out here wearing these little old shorts and things around, you know that's reflecting on your daughter? Did you know your grandmammy was a flapper? And your mammy, a coarse girl, and that's the reason you're a striptease today? Certainly, what will your children be? Yes, sir, God said he'd visit the iniquity of the parents upon the children and their children, the 3 and 4 generations. And do you realize, my brother, every time you do that which is right, that'll be visited on your children? Look here, let's take Hebrews the 7th chapter. The Bible said when Melchizedek met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the king and blessed him, and said, now, Levi is talking about paying tithes. Said, Levi had an order from the Lord to receive tithes from his brother. And Levi, who received tithes, paid tithes. For he was yet in the loins of Abraham when he met Melchizedek. And Abraham was his great-grandfather. Abraham got Isaac. Isaac got Jacob. Jacob got Levi. Levi, father, grandfather, great-grandfather. And while Levi was in the loins of Abraham, the Bible said he paid tithes to Melchizedek. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't can ever interfere with God's great call. She's moving right on. It was planned back in the beginning. There ain't a devil or enough devils can interfere with this program. Now, the Bible didn't say potentially he paid it. The Bible said he paid tithe. When he was in his great-grandfather's loins. Glory! That's my Lord! Oh, he knowed it even before the world was ever formed. He knew everything. And then Abraham, he paid tithe. And sister, brother, how can you run out here and people live and run around with man's wives and wives breaking up homes and living the way you do? What do you expect another generation to be? Here's what it is. It's become now nothing but just a bunch of illegitimate, messed up, born bunch of corruption. And there's one thing left for it. And that's the atomic day that we're living in. It's exactly right. We're at the end time. Sitting this morning, way back in the hills of Kentucky, a little old boy, you could hardly get 10 foot of him and make sorghum molasses. Probably didn't know hardly which was right hand or left. When he heard, I got over on a posted ground. I didn't know where it was. That was just in some of the hollers. And I was going up there to go squirrel hunting. And when I sat down up there, I got talking to him. And this boy said he's going in the army. And come to find out, we got to talking about the Lord. And he said, preacher, don't you believe that we're at the end time?
Amen.
Way back up there in that mountain. I said, sure we are. Sure, son. We're at the end time. Here we are. This is the hour that we're living, brother. We're in the place, can't you see how that mothers back down there and daddies, how they lived in grandpa and grandma? Can't you see how papa and mama has lived? No wonder we're in the corruption today. No wonder you could preach your hell. They'll wear shorts just the same as spit in your face. They'll smoke cigarette and blow right at you and say, tend to your own business. Why? Because that's the tribe they come out of. I'm going to get to that directly, the seed of the serpent. We find out where she moves in. See why they act like that? They're the devil's children since the foundation of the world. That's right. And we're nothing in left for it, to just judgment. The only thing is left. Can't have nothing else but judgment. God will just whack the whole thing out, and man has done it themselves. God didn't intend it to be that way, but he knew it would be that way. That's the reason he said he would deceive all that lived upon the face of the earth, except those whose names were put in the Lamb's Book of Life before the foundation of the world. Let's walk and read a little further now. Now, I believe we're on the 12, and the 10 horns, which thou sawest are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These shall have one mind, and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. And these shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And they that are with him are called the chosen and faithful. And he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the horse sitteth, are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. The 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore. Watch that now, these 10 horns, these 10 kingdoms, see? That's everything falling in. What these dictators are, watch the way dictators lean to. Where's it leaning to? Just tell me a dictator doesn't lean towards communism. See? And they shall what? Hate the whore, the woman, the church. What? Watch what's going to happen. These shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. They'll blow that thing off the map that the certain I'm standing here. We just had time to take up that subject there of that church and run on down through the scriptures where it said, read all the kings of this earth and all the shipmasters and all wail for great Babylon met her desolation in an hour. 1 hour, her time had come. And all I said, rejoice, you saints, and all you holy prophets, for God has revenged the blood of the saints and your brethren upon her. See, that's right. Sure, communism playing right into the hands of God, just like King Nebuchadnezzar played right in the hands to come take them Jews when they walked away. And sin can keep corrupting. Righteous seed can remain in there. And seed can keep corruption and corrupting until after a while it runs out. It gets to a place because our mothers and daddies and so forth have lived so before us, and that way till there's nothing left for us. And you know what Jesus said? If he didn't cut the work short, there'd be not even any flesh saved. Can you see? Can you see why we got these? I'm not making remarks. Arthur Godfrey's and everybody, you know, and Elvis Presley's and hips down the overhauls and hair hanging down their neck and all these ways that teenagers are acting. What does it? What is it? Because it's cut out of a bunch of four-lived, illegitimate people. Nothing left. Oh, they'll stand up and sing, "Dear my God," to thee, like P. Picker, Ernie, and all those others like that, sing some kind of a hymn and so forth like that. Brother, you know what? That's absolutely hypocrisy. Yes, sir. Man has got no business in this pulpit that gets out there and rock and roll and boogly woogly and all that kind of stuff. You haven't got one speck of business behind here. This is to the priesthood, the call of God. God's call ministers belong behind here. And don't belong back here for such as that. That's what's the matter with it today. They've made the church no more than some lodge. Lodge is all right. If you want to do that, that's up to you. But let me tell you, there's a lot of difference between a lodge and a church. Yes, sir. If you want to do those things in your lodge and have all them kind of parties and so forth, that's up to you. But brother, the church ought to be swept from the pulpit all the way to the basement. That's right. I don't mean swept with the new windows and so forth. I mean with an old-fashioned God-sent revival that will carry the thing from one side to the other. Yes, sir. Like turning a light, electric light on a bunch of roaches around a cob of an apple. Yes, sir. They'll scatter when the light flies. What? They have one mind, give their power. I'm below that now. The ten horns, yes. Now, for God has put in their hearts to fulfill His will. There you go. And to agree and give their kingdoms unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled. Now, and the woman which thou sawest is the great city which reigns over all the kings of the earth. Now, there's not no need of pushing around. We know that is the Catholic hierarchy. There's no need. There's anybody. I believe that just as firm as I believe that I have received the Holy Spirit. I believe that just as good as I believe that I'm a Christian standing here today, that Catholic hierarchy is the Vatican City is the city that sits on the seven hills. The hierarchy of the church is the beast which was, which is not. She's Babylon. It's everything pictured just exactly, just perfectly all the way through the Scriptures. Catholic Church. Now, here's your shocking point. You say, well, you didn't hit me, Brother Branham, but let me just ask you something. Let's go right back now to the fifth verse. And upon her head was written, Mystery Babylon, the great, the mother of abominations, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. What was she? W-H-O-R-E. And she was a M-O-T-H-E-R. What? M-O-T-H-E-R. She had begotten something. A mother of sons. Of harlots. What is a harlot? Same thing as a whore. Immoral woman. What made her immoral? Her doctrine. She is pretending to be a Christian church, but was giving out man-made dogma. And here she says that she had, if she was the first organization, then it seems like there's some organizations come out of her. She was the mother of harlots. Is that right? A mother of harlots. Couldn't be a mother now of boys. Couldn't be a mother of, it had to be mother of women. And if they were women, they were churches. Now let's find out. What come out of the, what was the first organization? Catholic Church. What was the second organization? Luther. What was the third organization? Swingley. What did come on down through Calvin and that come into Anglican, Anglican on down into Methodist? The Methodist. What did the Methodist produce? Out of there come Alexander Campbell. Out of Alexander Campbell come John Smith. Out of Alexander Campbell's a Christian church. Then it had four or five Church of Christ and all those other little isms run out. And then here come the Baptist church. It had a lot of little pullouts. And out of the Methodist church come first come the Wesleyan Methodists, and then they broke off four or five times, then they come to another type of Methodist, and then they come off again, then they come to the Free Methodist, and then they come from that to the Nazarene, and from the Nazarene to the Pilgrim Holiness, the Pilgrim Holiness on down, just little isms running out like that, keep running on down, each one of them little starters back there, come right on down, and why did every one of them do it? It finally winded up in Pentecost. And what did Pentecost do? The same thing their mammy did. They went right back and organized. And what did they become? A denomination. Walk into one. The first thing, what's your doctrine? Boy, they comb you with a fine-tooth comb. See? To find out what you are, what you believe in. You don't just tally right up with them, brother, you're excommunicated right now. That's right. And don't think it's because you say you're Pentecostal that you're secured. Brother, there'd be just as many Pentecostals off the road as there is on the road, I'm sure. See? Now, all those organizations, if they just let the Pentecostal blessing go, not organize it, just keep it in a brotherhood and let the Holy Spirit do the segregation. The Holy Spirit segregates. Ananias and Sapphira come in one time and said, so-and-so, and the Holy Spirit said, why did you lie? But we say, now that's Brother Jones. Don't you say nothing bad about him. Now he's the best fair we got in church. I know he got the Holy Ghost already speaking tongues, and I see him shopping spirit. They don't have no more important peas on a dry cowhide. See? Not a thing to do with it. God does the say. He's got to say whether he is or is not. Absolutely. But we took over to our denomination. Well, we kick him out of the assemblies. The oneness picks him up. The oneness carries him along, and then they kick him out. Because they carry more of that in the Jesus only picks him up. Jesus only packs him a while, and then the next thing picks him up is Church of God picks him up. Church of God of Prophecy picks him up, and the Tomlinson move gets him. Oh my. Brother, if we haven't about run out. That's in Pentecost, the last revival. And now they got the blue fame, and they got the oil worshipers, and the blood in the face, and oh, mercy, I don't know where they're going to now. Just one thing, that's the whole thing has become corrupted. Did you know the Bible said it would come corrupted? Did you know the Bible speaks that this day will be here when even the tables of the Lord will be full of vomit? And said, who can I teach doctrine? Who can I make understanding? For precept must be upon precept, upon precept, upon line upon line. Who can he teach doctrine? Those that are weaned from the breast, the mammy. Now there isn't a woman, ornery woman in this town, but what could bring forth a virgin daughter? She is when she's born. Now, and she can go good. But if you don't notice that her mother has been of that nature, that girl 9 times out of 10 will act just exactly like her mother does. Now you know that's right. An old woman that runs a house of ill fame could bring forth a little girl, she could be 16 years old, just as clean and moral as any lily. But if she remains that way, but the thing of it is, she goes right back and acts like her mother. Now the Catholic Church was the first old prostitute that's come up with doctrines that she made up of herself, superstitions, which the Bible said she come out of the bottomless pit and will go back to perdition. The Bible says that. Now, if they teach that, it's wrong. It's wrong according to God's Word. And then here comes the Methodist Church, which is born out of her. A beautiful young lady. But what did she do? She turned right back around and do the same things that her mammy does. Let your congregation wear shorts. Let them smoke cigarettes. Let them carry on and act just like they should. They never said about it. The little old half-baked pastor back behind there, the pulpit back there, is afraid he'll run out of salary someday or a pan of biscuits. Let me tell you, brother, I'd rather preach the gospel than eat salty crackers and drink branch water and tell the truth about it. If ever one of my congregation got up and walked out, I'd tell them the truth. Yes, indeed. What's the matter? Oh, it's a meal ticket. Well, you know, I'm the pastor of the biggest church there is in the city. You Baptists and Methodists listen to a false prophet. Now, that's rough. But anything that teaches contrary to this Bible is a false prophet. I don't care how polished it may be. It's false prophecy. Oh, everything's all right as long as you got your name on the book. You might have your name on a dozen books. If it ain't on the book of life, you're lost. You can be ever so good. You can be just as loyal and clean and moral as you can be. That won't have one thing to do with it. Esau was twice the guy that Jacob was when it comes to being a man. Taking care of his old blind daddy and everything else. And Jacob was a little shyster, hung around his mother's apron. Little old sissy boy. God said, I love Jacob and refused Esau before either boy was born. Yeah. Romans 8 says so. It's exactly right. God knows what's in man.
Yeah.
He knows what's in the church too. We live by the bread of life, the bread of the Word of God. Now, that's why we're not a denomination. Now, I want to give you another little, illustration I had wrote out here, the grape. Now, in Revelation 19:2, I got something marked out here. I want to look and see what it is now. For true and righteous are thy judgment, for he has judged the great whore, which did corrupt the earth with her fornications, and has avenged the blood of his servants at her hand. That's the ending of the Catholic Church. Now, we also want you to notice also here that a denomination is also found out in the scriptures here, that the Bible never speaks of a denomination. The denomination come from the Catholic Church. She is the first mother of denomination. And each denomination has come right down. Now, this is going to be just a little pinchy. It's going to get a little pinchier all the time. See? But I want you to see that denominations wasn't born or ordained of God. It was ordained of the devil. God's church is a... We are not divided. All one body we. One hope and doctrine. One charity. That's the church of the living God. Regardless of what they... Them things, we're one together. That's right. Whether he's Methodist or Baptist, brother, if he's born again and filled with the Holy Ghost, he's my brother. We're walking shoulder to shoulder. That's right. Yes, sir. Don't make any difference. Moses... Sometimes I look around and say, you know that bunch of fanatic Pentecostals? Brother Bram, why'd you ever go out of a bunch like that for? You know what? Moses looked upon the children of Israel. He looked out of the same window that Pharaoh looked out of. Pharaoh looked at him as a bunch of mud daubers. But Moses looked out upon them as the chosen of God. He knew they had the promise. Why? He knew it by the Word. And by faith with his foot on the throne to be Pharaoh, all the world laying at his feet, sit there and pour wine in his mouth and beautiful women to fan him. As the emperor of the dictator or king of the world, young Moses at 40 years old, had in his hand. And he looked out upon that bunch of mud daubers, but he knew he was one of them. Hallelujah. That's it. He knew he was one of them, and by faith alone he chose. Everybody's got to make a choice. You got to make a choice. You're going to make a choice now. You're going to make a choice in the morning. You're going to make a choosing tomorrow night if you live. You've got to choose sometime. Brother, a long time ago I chose this Bible as my dictionary. This Bible was my Book of Life. This Bible is the Word of God.
Amen.
The Bible is what I live by. This Bible is what I stand by. Yes. Therefore, Moses looked out upon the children of Israel. And not only did he say, oh, they're wonderful people. I have nothing against them. Oh, no, I wouldn't speak one word against them. That's the way a lot of people do today. Yes. Oh, those Pentecostals and those people who've got the Holy Ghost and those people who believe in divine healing. Oh, I ain't got nothing against it. But that wasn't Moses. He forsook Egypt and became one of them. He went out among his brethren. He was one of them. Brother, that's where I'll take my way. I'll take the way with the Lord's despised few. If it's a handful of whatever it is. They got a promise, and I see their names in the Lamb's Book of Life. They're my brethren. That's right. Take your choice and stand with them. Right or stand there anyhow. If they're wrong, help them to the right. Right. You never make them any better by kicking them around. See? Try to pull them out. Charlie, like you said about Brother Allen, about the fire, the blood in the hands, I said, never. Never did I disregard A.A. Allen. I said, if I could preach like A.A. Allen, I'd never even have a healing service. Now, when it comes to disagreeing upon blood as being the evidence of the Holy Ghost in your hands, I'll disagree with that. But when it comes to brotherhood, he's my brother. I stand shoulder to shoulder with him in the battle. That's right. If he's wrong, I'll try to help him. And if he's not wrong, if I'm wrong, I want him to help me. And that's the way we would get along. Now, watch here. She was Mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots. Now, do you see how the church today, friends, can you see how these churches today just live any way they want to live? Perfectly all right. Go right ahead, hog eat hog, pay no attention. Why, there's no harm in doing that. Well, you just try to be old-fashioned. Now, watch their doctrine. Now, watch, that's their habit. Do you see that a few years ago that the Catholic Church was the only one who was permitted to go to a picture show? The Methodist Church wouldn't think of such a thing. All them denominations, no, that's the works of the devil. I wonder what happened. Yes, sir. And you know, you take them young Catholic girls, they come out with these little... Now, some of you old boys as old as I am, come out and notice this little thing where they had the knee high. That guy, I guess, is in hell tonight. I don't know. I'm not his judge. But when he made that first little dirty song that slipped out on the radio without being censored, that roll 'em girlies, roll 'em down and show your pretty knees. How many remembers that when that first came out years ago? That was the first slip up right there. Right. And when they got this fellow from Texas and take them women out there and use them underneath clothes to make them look like they were something that they wasn't, and such things as that, and let them get by with it. And now what did it do? It went to creeping in. It's a spirit. A man was talking to me the other day. He said, I don't want more to do. I had a good, honest boy. And that boy's getting so he takes what he put his hands on. I said, why? He's associating with a thief. You hang around with somebody that's a thief, you'll be a thief yourself. My old Kentucky mammy, you say you lay down with a dog who's got fleas, you'll get up with fleas too. You take a woman that's no good, and a girl, and put her with a good, decent boy, and the first thing you know, he's as ornery as a pup. Turn it right vice versa. You're known by your company. Segregate yourself. Come out from among them, said the Bible. Be separated. That's right. If their denominations go back to such corruption as letting their people, well, here they're in a big, fine Baptist church. They had to disobey. They only could preach 20 minutes. The man could cause the pastor had to smoke. The congregation all went outside. All of them sit out there smoking, changed, and come back again. Pastor and all of them. I went to a congregationalist church. There a man sat in a big long robe on there and said, leaning on the pulpit like this, talking about some kind of a flower he found up on the hill. That's about all there was to it. And went back out and his fingers was yellow with cigarette smoke. Yes. And talking about at the women, as the man was going to play. What's this German game they play with that, so much you deal out cards, you know, I thought I'd remember. Pinochle. There's going to have a pinochle game. I think it's where you deal. It's regular playing cards. A pinochle game in the basement. My goodness. That's where its foundation is. No wonder. Why didn't they do that and then holler about the Catholic Church out here at these rotary places and playing lottery? Why, you Protestants are just as filthy as they are. So what can you say about it? Pop can't call kettles dirty. Certainly not. You're doing that and say, well, I'm a Presbyterian, I'm a Methodist, you're nothing. Until you're born again. That's right. And when you do that, you know there's something within you tells you those things are wrong. And you'll come out of it just as sure you're knee-high to a duck. You know that's the truth. Certainly. Why? The mother of harlots. It's one of these days old mothers go say, you know what? After all, honey, we're both the same. And you know what it is then? The confederation of churches are going to all unite together as they are now. And you know what's going to happen to a little group like this?
You're going to pay for it, boys. Said Zechariah. But don't worry, the Lamb shall overcome him.
Yeah. For he's the Lord of lords and the King of kings. Then go to leading his church instead of a denomination. He'll pour out that golden oil of the Holy Ghost upon that church. Brother, fire fall from heaven and signs and wonders will take place like you've never seen before. Yes, sir. Hear not, little flock, it's your Father's goodwill to give you the kingdom. Yes, sir. He that endureth to the end. There you go. Keep right down the road. Keep your head towards Calvary. This Bible's right. Don't worry. Now watch, there's some of the habits they have. Some of the morals that they have. We can just go on. First thing, they'll leak into the Protestant churches. Then the Catholic women begin to, well, it wasn't no harm to put on little shorts. As long as you went to church and put a little handkerchief over their head. Some kind of tradition. Don't eat any meat on Friday. And where you ever find putting a handkerchief on your head to enter church? I want you to show me the scripture. It's false prophecy. Where is it in the church you're supposed to wear a hat in the church? When you wear a hat on your head, you dishonor Christ. Right? Man, I'm speaking of. Women, you do have a covering. But I'll challenge anybody to show me where it's a hat or a handkerchief. It's your hair. And you cut it all off. Now what about that? Oh, they say that's old fashioned. If it is, it's a Bible. God's word's right. Speaking here not long ago of the woman that washed Jesus' feet and took her hair on and wiped it with it. I said the only way a woman could do that is stand on her head to get enough hair down there to wash his feet. It's a disgrace. See the way here, freezing weather, walking around with a little chubby coat on like that and their naked body showing. Well, I say, why are you picking on women? You need to be picked on. And you, man, to let your women do that, brother, I don't know what to think about you. Now, that's right. And you pastors, I don't guess you're here, but if you see the guy, you can't come tell him, see me, see? If he's got no more respect for Christ than to let his congregation get by with that they might do it out there behind him, but if he don't tell them about it, he's not a fit servant for Jesus Christ. Exactly right. He is not fit to be a servant of Christ. A servant of Christ should be fearless if cause it comes to the Bible. Certainly. But there they are. They go out and they do it anyhow. And then the first thing you know, the Protestants had to pick it up. You good Methodists, and you Baptists, and you Presbyterian, and all Nazarene Pilgrim Holiness and all of you. Same thing. Got right up six of one, half a dozen of the other. There you are. Mother of harlots. Your denomination, as long as they started at a headquarters, what difference did it make? See? Makes a whole lot of difference. It never started that headquarters. Might start at your headquarters down here, but not that one up there. Depends on where you're from. That's true. Now, I don't think we have time to get this other one. Maybe we better leave it for in the morning. All right. Let's just take a little short one. We got your baptism in water. We also got predestination and all many things. So let's just take this this little short one of women preachers and get this one. Now, our lady preacher, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but I want to tell you something. You haven't got one speck of scripture. Not one in the Bible. Yeah, I know where you're going to and have done had all your, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Now, if your pastor don't know what the name prophesy means, he ain't got very much business behind the pulpit trying to tell you to be a preacher, see. Because it absolutely is condemned from Genesis to Revelations. Now, let me show you this. Now, I want you to turn me to 1 Timothy 2:11. Just turn over here and find out. And we'll get that. Your Acts 2. Just listen here what the Scripture has to say about this subject. Now, somebody kept saying, well, Brother Brandon, you're no woman hater. I'm not no woman hater. I just don't like to see women try and take a place that they don't belong in. You remember in Howard Shipyard over here, one of the most successful shipyards there is on the Ohio River, they put a woman over, look what happened. They give the woman a right to vote, look what happened. Let me tell you right now, not the skin women, I want man to understand you're in on this too. But let me tell you something, brother. This nation is a woman's nation.
I'll prove that by you, by the scripture, by anything that you want to prove about. This is what appears on our money, a woman. What she found out in Revelation here? You see her. She's number 13 also. Everything she started, 13 stars, 13 stripes, 13 colonies, 13, everything was 13 to be. She appears in the 13th chapter of Revelation. A woman, 13. And in 1933, when we was having meetings over here where that Church of Christ is standing now, the old Masonic home, the vision of the Lord came to me up here and predicted that Germany would rise up and put that Magnot line there. Many of you remember. And how they'd be all fortified in there, and the Americans would take a great beating right there at that line. It also said what would take place and about Roosevelt and them things, how he would run and make that fourth term perfectly, just exactly the way it come to that. And it also said that cars would keep getting more like an egg until the last days they'd be just in the shape of an egg. Now I said it'll come to pass that those cars will not be run by a steering wheel. It'll be something other to run. It's them cars they're bringing out right now, remote control for safety. Correct. You won't be able to enter into a city, then you, 20 miles zone, you can just go 20 miles. You can't hit another car because it's remote control. See, it's going like that right now. Now I said, remember, in that day, before the end time comes, that a woman, now you all keep this wrote down, there will be a great powerful woman raised up either to be president or dictator or some great powerful woman in this United States. And she'll sink under the influence of women. Now, you remember, that's thus saith the Lord. See? And she's wrong. And what is it given away to? Let me tell you. Be spiritual. Open up. Look, why is it doing that? To give the Catholic Church a place to come in. See, you worship these movie stars and all these other different things I hear. Remember the sermon I preached, Margie, you remember, years ago on the invasion of the United States to overthrow the American government. And how did I say he raised up in Paris after we saved him over there from that women whining big time. And he lit right down in Hollywood. Now instead of us sending to Paris to get models, they send here to get models. What did he do? We wouldn't let your children go at the picture show, but he got right into the television, moved right on out, and contaminated the whole thing, running right on out. And here we are today, all the little girls and boys, all like some kind of these television actors. What is it? It's making a way. Boy, one ill-famed woman can send more people to hell than all the bootleg joints you can put in the city. Right. Watch her go down the street with her clothes all stripped down. Don't care who the man is. If he's a healthy, normal man, when he looks at the woman, he's bound to have something to pass over him. I'd just be honest. I don't care. I've had the Holy Ghost for years. You can't look at a woman in her half-dress. I carry a little cross in my car. Many of you have seen it. Somebody said to me, are you a Catholic? Where did the Catholics ever get an option on the cross? The cross means Christian. Them little old Saint Cecilia's and things is a mark of Catholicism. We don't believe in such stuff as that. We believe in Christ. They have all kinds of dead people they worship. It's a high form of spiritualism. That's all it is, worshiping the dead. No such a thing. No, I asked that priest, I said, why did then, if Peter was the first pope, he said, that's right. I said, then why did Peter say, there's no other mediator between God and man but that man Christ Jesus. And you've got 5,000 dead women and everything else you're making mediators. Now what's happened? There you are. They ain't got an answer for that. That's right. Now, some of their doctrine, their false doctrine, a bunch of false Protestant prophets has come around and teaching that, and you Protestant people are swallowing it. That's exactly right. Denominations and forms of baptisms and different orders and things that you're going through, which is absolutely not scriptural. It's against it in the scripture, yet you're not right down to it. It's the truth. Now, listen to this about the women preachers. All right, 1 Timothy, I want the 1 Timothy 2:11. Now listen to what it says here. Let your women learn in silence with all subjections, but I suffer not a woman to teach or to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. I'm not responsible for putting it in there. I'm responsible for telling you it's in there. See, let your women learn in silence and be in all subjections. If you're going into an Orthodox church, you're watching, see? But I suffer not a woman to teach or to usurp authority, be a pastor, deacon, or anything like that, over the man, usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. For Adam was first formed and then Eve. Did you know? Now listen, women. You good, righteous Christian women are the best thing that God could give a man, or He'd give him something different. Yes, sir. See? A woman was not even in the original creation. The woman is not a created product of God. She's a byproduct of a man. God made the man, both man and woman. And He separated them. And if the man had already lived on the earth and named the beast and lived here a long time, He took a rib out of Adam's side as a byproduct and made a woman to it. Adam was first formed and then Eve. Now watch. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. God took the man, the devil took the woman. Look at it right straight in the face. What's doing it today? Look at the real church of God will say, Jesus! The Antichrist will say, Mary! Watch them spirits. There they are. Hail Mary, Mother of God, blessed art thou among women. Pray for us sinners now and the day of our death. Amen. Very praiseful. Oh, my goodness. See? There you go. Woman. The devil's subject. Christ! The object of worship and the only one. There you are. There you are. Adam was first formed and then Eve. Adam was not deceived. And how could you have a woman pastor, deacon? Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived. She was actually, she didn't think she was wrong, but she was. The woman being deceived was in the transgression. Because every time that a funeral goes down the street, a woman caused it. Every time a baby screamed out, a woman caused it. Every time someone died, a woman caused it. Every gray hair, a woman caused it. Everything in death, a woman caused it. Everything that's wrong, a woman caused it. And then put her head of the church. Pastor, old bishop sometimes. Shame on you. Now, let me turn you to this another just in a minute. Now let's turn to 1 Corinthians 14:32 there. See what Paul says over here. And then we're going right over to some of the Lord just in a minute. And then we don't want to keep you too long so you'll be so tired in the morning you can't come back. All right? I want to read. How many believe that Paul was an inspired teacher? Now remember, Paul wrote this to Timothy also.
Yes.
See, now, 1 Corinthians 14:32. Now, let's start right in here and start reading. 14:34, I'll be. Let your women keep silent in the churches. Did you hear what he said? Let your women keep silent in churches, for it's not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience. Have you a margin reading on that? If you are, run it back, see if you don't take Genesis 3:16. When God told Eve, because she had listened to the serpent instead of her husband, that he had ruled over her all the days of her life. How can the woman come and rule over a man, be pastor or deacon, when the Bible said, let her be obedient, just like it was in the beginning when God can't change. You can't make the Word say one thing here, another thing over here. Don't do it. It's the same thing all the time. So in the beginning, that's where, before this is over, if we get a chance, I want to straighten out that marriage and divorce case for you. I've never done it in this church yet. Watch the devil covenant. One says she can marry, another said he can't marry, and this one says this, that, the other. Just wait a minute and see what the Bible says when we get to that. All right. Now watch here. Let your women keep silent in the churches. It's not permitted to them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. Then in the Old Testament, they wasn't allowed to speak. Because Paul said here they wasn't. Is that right? Let your women keep silent. It's obedience. Now, if you will run your margin, you're going to take you back to Genesis 3:16. See? All right? As under the law, if they learn anything, let their heads us for husbands home, for it's a shame for a woman to speak in the church. What? Now, look at that question mark on each one of your Bibles on that what. What caused Paul to say that in the heck of that kind? Now, if you'll ever get the letters that the Corinthians wrote to Paul, now you can get them in any good library, see? That the Corinthians wrote to Paul, they wrote and told him, after these women who was converted, they had a goddess over there, it was called Diana, and she was of Ephesus also, and the Corinthians worshipped the same, because it was a heathen worship, and they found a rock out in the field one day, it looked like a shape of a woman, they said, God is a woman, and she dropped her image down to us, and their temple was far beyond the Solomon temple, they said, the historians. Oh, it was all marble inlaid with gold, where Solomon's temple was made of cedar inlaid with gold. See? And it was far beyond it. And that, then, if God was a woman, well, sure she'd have women priests. Sure, if God is a woman, then the woman preacher's right. But if God is a man, the Bible said he was a man, and he is a man. See? And if God was a man, then it should be man. Now, notice here. What? Now, some of them women priests, when they was converted from paganism into Christianity, they thought they could maintain their office as a preacher. Just come out on over. If they preached over there about Diane, they come over here and preach about Christ. He said, what? Came the word of God out? Just listen to this. Brother, how can ministers do that? 36th verse. What? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? If any man thinks himself to be a prophet or spiritual, don't even have to be a prophet, it's a spiritual thinking man, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. You believe that? But if any be ignorant, just let him be ignorant. Now that's just as flat as I know to put it. He said, if a man is a spiritual man or a prophet, he'll acknowledge that what I write here is the commandments of the Lord. But said, if he's going to be ignorant, just let him be ignorant. See? The only thing you can do is they want to go on to it, you just have to let them go. Because he's seen it starting there. And some woman told me, said, Paul was just an old woman hater. He was no woman hater. You know, Paul was the apostle and to the Gentile church. Look here, did you know Paul, how many believe that's what Paul preached? Is that what he said here? And Paul said, you say, well, wait a minute now, Brother Branham, just a minute. Now, our bishop says that's all right. The general overseer of the assembly says it's all right. The one that's bishop says it's all right. I don't care what they say. It's false. And I told you he was going to stick this hard. And it's false prophets that say so. For the Bible said, if any man thinks himself to be a spiritual or a prophet, let him acknowledge what I say is the commandments of the Lord. And if his spirit don't bear record with that word, he's a false prophet to begin with. I'd rather be a woman hater than a woman lover to go such stuff as that, to put up with such stuff as that in the church of God, contrary to the ordinances of God. And Paul said, get Galatians 1:8. Paul said, if an angel from heaven would preach any other gospel than that what I preached unto you, let him be accursed.
Amen.
Now, what are you going to do about that? Now, you say, what about where it said your sons and daughters shall prophesy in Joel, and where Peter quoted on the day of Pentecost, that said, Zechariah, did you know in the Old Testament that the only way now that anybody can come into the covenant through by Abraham was the one that was given the promise, and the seal of the promise was by circumcision. How many knows that? That was God confirming. Like a Baptist brother. He said, Brother Branham, while we Baptists have received the Holy Ghost, I said, when did you get it? He said, the hour we believed. I said, Paul said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? I said, now you Baptists come get some of that and we'll talk some eternal security with you. I said, but well, where do you get it like that? See? He said, have you received it since you have believed? They were believers and having shouting and joy and everything else. They hadn't received the Holy Ghost yet. Paul said they hadn't. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? They said, we know not where there be any Holy Ghost. Said, then how was you baptized? They said, we've been baptized, but falsely. See? So he had to be baptized over again. All right. Now, notice this now. That these women preachers, when they come in, they want to take their authority, but it's absolutely not permitted by God to do so. And just while we're right on this subject here, this women see, and I said, if there be any man among you who's spiritual or a prophet, let him acknowledge that what I write is the commandments of the Lord. But if he's ignorant, just let him be ignorant. And that's why this tabernacle does not stand and ordain women preachers, women deacons, or anything for a woman to do as the office of this church. Is because this scripture lays here and it's naked. Now, the Bible did say, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Now, what does the word prophesy mean? Look it up. It's to tell something under inspiration Or foretell something. It's a compound word. It's like sanctify. It means to be cleaned and set aside for service. See? Or it's a compound word meaning more than one thing. Like we got so much of it in English here. Like we'd say the word board. Well, what would board mean? You say, well, he means he paid his board. No, he never even meant he bored a hole. No, he never even meant he bored him. See? Just the word, you have to know what you're talking about. See? And that's the way it is. This compound word where your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Now, the only way that God, this Baptist said, well, we have received the Holy Ghost. I said, then, when we believed it. I said, now see, he said, God give Abraham said, Abraham believed God. That's the way he put it. He said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. How many knows that's the truth? Now watch how easy Satan can slip that on a brother. See? Just as easy. Now that's scripture. Brother, I'm telling you, up here you should be anointed before you enter this. You should enter into a secret place and pray. People say, well, why don't you go out and see the people? Brother, if you're going to talk to the people or teach them, you better stay to yourself with God for a while before you enter that pulpit. Certainly. See? Because Satan is shrewd. Very shrewd. Said, now, notice. He said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. That's right. He said, now, what more can Abraham do but believe? I said, that's all he could do. He said, how much more can you do or anybody else do but believe? I said, that's all we can do. But look, brother, then God reconciled or recognized Abraham's faith. He gave him the seal, a sign of circumcision, as a seal of the covenant. See? He gave him, he said, now Abraham, I recognize your faith, so I'm going to give you a sign now that I have received you. So he circumcised Abraham. And that was the seal of the covenant. And now in this day, now a woman could not be in that covenant. Only a married woman. Find out. Couldn't circumcise a female. So it had to come in. So her and her husband are one. They're not more two, they're one. How many knows that? Scripture says so. So her being married, then she become one. And going down here, look at over here in Timothy, it said the same thing. So notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if she continues in faith and holiness with all sobriety. Now, but then the circumcision of the Old Testament was in the flesh, but in this New Testament, Joel said, I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Now, the word prophesy does not mean to teach. The prophesy means to either tell an experience or inspiration or foretell something is fixing to take place. And we know that there was prophetess in the Old Testament. They never could speak out in the buildings, speak out in the churches and the congregation as a teacher. But she, Anna, and many of them in the temple, they were prophetess, and they were, Miriam was a prophetess or something like that. She had the Spirit on her, that's true. But she had her limitations of place. Women can be prophetess today, absolutely, but not teachers and so forth behind the platform here. If you do, you make the Bible contradict itself. The Bible can't say one thing here, another thing over here. It's got to say the same thing all the time, or it isn't the Word of God. See? So your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Means that they shall either foretell or testify. Now you look that up and you get the Bible dictionary and see if that isn't right. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Now, the Bible also speaks of a woman who pretended herself, or claimed that she, this would work both with the Catholic Church and would work also with this subject we're going to speak of. Now let's turn over to the book of Revelations, and let's get about the second chapter in the 20th verse, just while we're right here close to it, that you might notice here, and just see how the devilish that thing can be. Speaking in this last days, what will take place, how these, what this woman would be. Remember, the Catholic Church is a woman. We just read it, haven't we? Listen to this now. That's Revelations 2 and 20. Now we're standing, he's speaking to this Tyra church, see? Now we're standing, which is a middle-aged church there, through the dark ages. Now we're standing, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calls herself a prophetess, to teach and subdue my servants and commit fornications and to eat things sacrificed to idols. Now, if you ever notice, watch these church ages. Then we'll close. And then in the morning, we'll go pick up these other things. Watch. in the under the golden candlesticks of the Jewish tabernacle in the inside of the showbread and so forth, there were seven golden candlesticks. All of you know that. The seven church ages. That speaks of seven church ages alike. Now, if you notice, in Revelations 1, we find Jesus standing in the seven church ages, the seven golden candlesticks. When he turned, he saw one like the Son of Man, standing clothed with a, what was it? Was a bride standing in the candlesticks, drawn out. Now, in the Old Testament, they would take this one candle and light it, take the other candle and light off that one, one off the other, like that, till they made the entire seven candlesticks. If you'll notice at the beginning when God began to deal with the Jews, and they went through the golden age, and then the darkest age of the Jewish dealings God had with Jews was in the reign of Ahab. And if you'll notice reading those church ages there, he gets right back to it again. He said, now, a few things go, and said, now, right in that dark age, 1500 years there, or the time of Ahab first in the Jews, the darkest age they had, when Ahab married Jezebel, and brought idolatry into Israel, and made all the people worship after Ahab, after Jezebel's God. You remember they put up the groves and tucked down the altars of God, and Elisha cried out, he was the only one, and God had 700 who never bowed their knee to Baal yet. You remember that? That's a type of that elect church coming out. See there? See how it is? Now, in this church, if you'll notice, the first church, the church of Ephesus, was a great church. He said, you got light yet. And if you notice, each church, it began to dim out. Dim out. Yeah. Dim out until it got to Tyre. And then the 1500 years, then he come out on the other side, and you've got just a little light, strengthen that which you have got, lest your candlestick be removed. And it come on down then to the Philadelphia church age, and then into the Laodicean church age. Now, here's the beauty. Oh, my, I just love this, Brother Smith. See, look at this. Now, in this church age, as we went through, now watch this. The first church age was the Ephesus, the Ephesian church age. Now, each one of those church ages, till he got to this 1500 years, if you notice, read it now. When you go home tonight, if you have time, or early in the morning before you come to church, on the first, second, and third chapter of Revelation, you'll find out each one of those church ages, he said, you have a little strength, and you haven't denied my name. Until he got to this 1500 years of Tyre, the dark age, then he come out on the other side and said, you have a name that you live, but you are dead. And none of these other church ages, that the Philadelphian church age, never did pick up that name again. Never got that name, because it went out during this time. Now, oh, how we could lay that onto them false teachings now. Right in there, show it's a mother, the Catholic Church, the mother of all of it. How she's Mother Mystery Babylon. And that's, look, this church age here, when she come out, she had a little light. Then she went getting dimmer. Then she come into an organization back here, this 1500 years. And she come out now, not as the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, but as the Catholic Church. What did Luther come out? As the Lutheran Church. What did the Baptist come out? As the Baptist Church. Not his name. Not his name, another name. You have a name. For there's not another name given under heaven whereby you may be saved, only the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You have a name. That you're living, but you're dead. That's what that denomination. Oh, I'm a Presbyterian, and you're dead. Oh, I'm a Baptist, and dead. You're only alive as you come alive in Christ Jesus. That's right. Your false baptisms, water false baptisms, sprinkling, poured instead of immersing, using Father, Son, and Holy Ghost instead of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. All those false things coming right down the Bible, speaking right, pouring it into it just as hard as it can. And here we tolerate right along with them. Well, my church leads it this way, but the Bible says this. No such things. There's no such thing. That old place in the Bible, did they ever stick out their tongue and take the Holy Eucharist and the priest drank the wine and call it the Holy Ghost? Never in the Bible did they ever shake hands and give the right hand of fellowship and call it the Holy Ghost? Never did anybody raise up and say, now I'm a believer and receive the Holy Ghost? If it did, here's the way Acts 2 would have to read. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, down the road come a Roman priest, and he had his collar turned around. He walks up and said, all these stick out your tongue now and take the Holy Eucharist, First Communion. Wouldn't that be some way to read Acts 2? Well, you Protestants are as bad, come back right there. Now we walk up to you Methodists, put them on the right hand, give them the right hand of fellowship and 6 months off probation. Where do you read that in Acts 2? Where do you get that? See, it said when they were all in one place and one accord. There never come up no bishop and done this, and there never come up no priest and done this, but there came a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind and filled all the house where they were sitting. There's the way they received it. Yes, sir. As a rushing mighty wind coming from glory, not up the road or from some denomination. You have a name that you're living, but you're dead. See? Your creeds and denominations have barred God away like that. So that we believe this and we believe the days of miracles is past. It's a false prophet that says that. It's a false prophet that tells you that you can shake hands and receive the Holy Ghost. It's a false prophet that tells you you receive the Holy Ghost when you believe. It's a false prophet that tells you you should be poured and sprinkled instead of baptized. It's a false prophet that tells you to be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost when there's no scripture for it in the Bible. Right. There's not a scripture in the Bible tells you to be baptized where anybody was ever baptized only in the name of Jesus Christ. Only John's disciples, and they had to come be re-baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to get the Holy Ghost. That's right. Now, that's not Jesus' only doctrine. I know Jesus' only doctrine. That's not it. That's just Bible doctrine. That's right. But there you are. What do you do with it? There's your mammy. There's the mammy of those creeds. Now, you look right back in the Bible and tell me where anybody was ever sprinkled. Methodist, Presbyterian, Catholic. Tell me where one person's ever sprinkled in the Bible. Tell me where one has ever poured in the Bible for remission of sin. Mention it. Can you find it? If you do, come to me and I'll walk down the street with a sign on my back and say, a false prophet, I've been wrong. Or you find one place in the entire Bible where anybody was ever baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The way 80% of you has been baptized. Find me one scripture where anybody was ever baptized that way, and I put a sign on my back, false prophet, and walk down the road with it like this. And show me where anybody was ever baptized in the new church that didn't have to come and be re-baptized over in, not in the name of Jesus only, but in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's right. See if that isn't right. And here, what is it? She was a mother of harlots. What was made her a harlot? What made her a whore? Her doctrine. What made them a harlot? Her doctrine. And that's the reason we don't tolerate with their denominations and their dogma. We stay clean with this Bible. I don't know how well you live it, but you're taught it anyhow. Right? That's up to you. I can't make you live it. I can only tell you what's the truth. That's why we're not a denomination. I wouldn't want to defile ourselves to get into such a stuff as that. Have to knock down to some kind of dogma. I'd rather take the way with the Lord's despised few. I'd rather stay clean and pure before the Word and God and stand there and say there's no man's blood upon my garments. That's why we stay at the Branham Tabernacle. That's why we're not assemblies. That's why we're not oneness. That's why we're not Jesus only. That's why we're not Methodists. That's why we're not Baptists. It's just a little tabernacle here. We don't have no denomination at all. We're free in Christ. That's why we stay the way we do. And God has blessed us. God helping us. Now we tell you why we take communion. We tell you why we take feet washing. Why we won't let the members take it if we know they're in sin. And that's why this last 2 or 3 weeks I've been going from one member to the other. Where you've been having your little fusses around too. Go around one and speak to the other and pass one another on the road and turn your head. Shame on you! Who's tucked a blessed cup of God across this the altar here and called you brothers and sisters and then get on the telephone and gad off about one another? You're not fit to be called Christians. Right. You keep off them telephones. If you can't talk good about somebody, don't you talk at all. Remember, God's going to hold you responsible. As long as that kind of spirit's in you, you know you're not right with God. If you don't feel if a man's in the wrong, go to him and be reconciled. If you can't be reconciled, take somebody with you. No wonder God can't discipline his church. Because you're not doing it right. Instead of getting on the phone and talking about this and what's taking place in little cults and so forth around like that, instead of doing that, why don't you do what the Bible says? If some brother's been overtaken in the fault, go to him. And see if you can't get reconciled with him. Well, now, he did me, I don't care what he did, go to him anyhow. It didn't say for him to come to you, you go to him if he's wrong. You'd say, well, he was in the wrong. He ought to come to me. That's not what the Bible said. The Bible said for you to go to him.
Amen.
If he's wrong, you go to him. And then if he won't listen to you, then take somebody with you as a witness. And then if you won't see that witness, then say, now I'll take your pastor. Then you tell him, say, I'm going to tell it to the church. And in 30 days from now, if you, brethren, haven't made that up, this brother here is willing to be reconciled, you won't do it. And if you won't make that up within 30 days, then what's going to happen? You're no more one of us. The Bible said, if you won't hear the church, then let him be unto you as a heathen and a publican. You see, as long as a brother is under that protection of the church, the blood of Christ is protecting him. That's the reason we don't get the church rolling on the way it does. Now, this is the doctrine of the Baptist Church of the Brand Tabernacle here. If you'll do it. See, why can't you get here, say, for instance, two men. Say, Leo and I. Well, you have it, and I say, well, he wronged me. That don't make any difference. I'm supposed to go to him. Well, he's a member of this church. He's become a Christian. He's taken the communion here at the rail with me. And we've been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, walked upright as brothers before each other. And then something happens. It ain't the man. 90% of the time, it's the devil got between the people. It ain't the people. It's the devil. And as long as you let the devil do it, that you're harming your brother. That's right. Well, something's wrong with Leo and I. Let's go make it up. If you see there's something, it's your duty to come to us and say, both you boys come here and get together. We go straighten this thing up. Now, then if he comes to there and they come to find out then, here we are. I say, well, first thing, if we can't agree, then you come to the church like that. And then if, as long as you don't do nothing about it, the blood of Jesus Christ protects us both. See? Well, then that old cancer will start another cancer. And that cancer will start another cancer. And the whole thing will be sick all over the whole church. Then you get to a place, you come into church, you're just cold, you'll have to have the janitor come break the icicles out before the congregation can get in. Now, you know that's right. The cold, somebody sit around, you know, and just don't say nothing. Well, we used to be so spiritual. Well, what happened? You did run well. What was the matter? See? Your sin separates you. God will hold you responsible for it, brethren. Now, straighten this thing up. Nothing but wrong with me, nothing wrong with Leo. It's the devil got between us. Let's try to get the thing straightened out. Go to him. Then if he won't listen, or I won't listen, whichever way it is, then tell it to the church. If he don't come be reconciled to that church in 30 days, then he's out from under the protection of Jesus. We loose him. It's exactly right. Then watch what takes place. Let God do the discipline then. You got your hands off. You've done the best you could. Then let God have him for a little bit. He'll turn him over to the devil. He will come then. If he don't, his life is just a short span. You remember the Bible? Where there's a brother that wouldn't get right with God? How many remembers the case? He lived with his foster mother. And they couldn't get him straightened out. Paul said, turn him over to the devil. For the destruction. You find out in 2 Corinthians he got straightened out. I've got a brother. A good friend. I care to call his name. The preacher brother. And this preacher brother, his name's Brother Rasmussen. Many of you ministers sitting here tonight, his name's on your papers. Is that interdenominational out of Chicago? And look, he had a boy, minister. And he went and married a Catholic girl and started off like that, and he's going to do this, that, and the other. And what all, got in some trouble. And his daddy went to him and said, now look, son, are you going to be reconciled? Said, daddy, he called a church, a bunch of holy rollers, his daddy. He said, now look, are you going to straighten that thing up at this church? He said, now, daddy, you're my daddy, and I don't want to get any trouble with you. All right. He went and got one of the deacons and went out to his house. Said, Wesley, I want to talk to you. Said, are you going to straighten this thing up with the church? And he gave him a sharp to answer like that. Said, remember, Wesley, I'm the pastor of that church. I'm your daddy. But I'm going to do what God says do. I'm giving you 30 days to make that right with that church, or we'll excommunicate you in the presence of God. If you're my own son, that's my Savior. I love you. You know I love you, Wesley. I'd die right now for you. But you've got to come straight with God's Word. He said, I'm the pastor. I'm the shepherd of that flock. If you're my child or whoever you are, you've got to line up with God's Word. If you don't do it, then I'm not fit to be a shepherd. Boy, that's a pastor. That's a man. Don't you think so? That's a man. He told his boy that and hurt him, he said. But said, what? Who you ought to hurt? The man or hurt your Savior? So he said, then we went on. and said he wouldn't do it. And we told the church and said, my own son, Wesley, he refuses to hear me in this matter. He refuses to hear the deacon. You're witness of this, brother so-and-so. Yes, I am. All right. But at 8 o'clock, next Sunday, 4 weeks from now, if he hasn't made that right with this church, we turn Wesley, my son, over to the devil for the destruction of the flesh. The blood of Jesus Christ in this church protects him no longer. And that night come, stood on the pulpit, said, he's got 2 more minutes. And time come, he said, now, as my son Wesley Rasmussen said to this congregation, to you, Almighty God, we've done all we can do according to your words and instructions of your son, our Savior, has left us. We now, I turn my boy and this church with me over to the devil for the destruction of his flesh, that his soul would be saved. That's all we said. Nothing went on for a week or two, maybe a month or two. One night, old Wesley took sick. And when he got sick, he kept getting sicker. He called the doctor. The doctor come up and examined him. He had a fever of 105, couldn't find no reason for it. He just kept getting sicker. The doctor said, boy, I don't know what's happened to you. He didn't know what to do. He said, we'll call a specialist. They call a specialist, and the specialist come in there. They took him over to the hospital, examined him and everything else. He said, I just can't tell you. The boy just looks deathly. His wife's down there crying and everything like that, and the children standing around the bed and everything like that. And he said, he's going. That's all. He said, his pulse of respiration is just going down all the time. He said, call Daddy. Oh, yeah. That's the way to do it. That's it. Call Daddy. And his daddy run out there to the hospital real quick to see him. He said, Daddy, I can't now, but God hears my words. I'll make everything right. I'll make it right. Yes, I will. Yes, sir, brother. Right then his respiration began to come back normal. And the following Sunday, he was up before the church. He said, I have sinned before God in the presence of this church. I refuse to hear the pastor's words. I refuse to hear the deacon here. And said, I'm asking this church to forgive me for the evil that I have done. Like that. That God has spared my life. I tell you, he lined up right. That's what you got to do, see? If you just do it God's way. See? Now, see, the way we do, we have a board meeting, and we say, well, now, should we keep, I don't say the tabernacle, but I mean us Protestant people. We have a board meeting, and what do you think about Jones? What do you think we ought to do with him? I think he'd make the Methodists a better member than he does us. There you are. That's wrong. That's the reason we don't have to follow their traditions, and some bishop, we have to call him, or some, what does you call him, district man in this Pentecostal church, district presbyter, call him in to see the conduct of this man. The Bible tells us what to do. That's the reason we don't fool with their denominations. We stay free from that thing. Amen. Not mad at me, are you? Don't you do it. I'll probably get some awful good questions tomorrow night, but that's right, see. Remember, no, I say this now, you people that's here from different denominational churches, your denomination, brother, I'm not saying that you're not a Christian, I'm not saying your denomination, there isn't thousands of lovely Christians in there. I'm trying to say the reason that we are not a denomination, because I just wouldn't stand for that. No, sir. I sure wouldn't. We're trying to tell you what to do. If God called me to preach the gospel, then I preach it the way God tells me to do it. That's just the way it's wrote in your life. If I don't line up with this, then that's God will judge me for it. But if I see the wolf coming or the enemy coming and I fail to warn him, then God requires me. But if I warn you, then it's up to you then. See, remember, there in the last days, a perilous time shall come. Man shall be lovers of themselves, boasters, proud, blasphemers. Blasphemers, all them bunch of idiots. The days of miracles are past. There's no such thing. He's an old false prophet. Now, we know that our women have just as much sense as our men. I'm not disputing that a bit, but God's Bible said, keep her out of the pulpit. That's good enough for me. See, that's right. All right. And said, well, now our denominations, we got just as many nice people as you got over that tabernacle. I don't say that a bit, but the Bible condemns denominations. That's right. And so, I ain't saying you ain't got fine members in your church. That's wonderful. They are fine people. Some of the finest people, I meet them in all of them, Catholics and all through. All of them, I meet fine members. Now, the way we're going to bring this out, friends, if the Lord willing, in these next couple of studies, maybe I'll let you know tomorrow morning whether we have to run tomorrow afternoon or not, see, to get it out. The reason we're trying to, I want to bring it down to a spot now. Now, if you want to bring someone with you, you're perfectly welcome to do it. But remember, now don't go away and just kind of find fault. You're coming here. Well, I'm just talking to my congregation, you see. I don't teach this outside my congregation here because that's the other man's business. that he's the shepherd of that flock, and I'm just the... Right back to Genesis, you'll pull it right through and see where it's at. Now, we're going back to Genesis to find out why that illegitimate child would not enter the congregation of the Lord for 14 generations. I take that would be 400 years for that sin to run out. How we're going to find out how that the righteousness of the parents' visit to the children and children, how that started in Genesis, and so forth. And then you'll see how that all the way back that God, before the foundation of the world, before one atom ever bursted, back then before there ever was a light meter ever come into existence, God knew every creature and everything that would ever be on the earth. Is there anyone here, you could not explain what the word and break it down and say what the word of infinite means? It's like turning your camera to infinite. It's just from there on. That's all, see? Infinite. And we can't in a finite mind ever comprehend what the infinite mind could conceive. See, we can't do that. You can't do it, see? But if you just watch, hold in the Spirit, you can feel it way off there. And you then get back here to Scripture, and you'll see now, see, way before the foundation of the world was ever laid. Now the Bible says that Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God. Now listen real close so some of you won't be in tomorrow to hear it finish up. The Bible said that Jesus Christ was the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. Is that right?
Amen.
When was he slain? From the foundation. That's the world. If it's made out of a bunch of broken up atoms pulled off the sun yonder before it was that, then before there was an atom ever first broke in the sun, if this is a meter off the sun, which would be 100 billion trillion 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 of years back, before there was even one light meter, Christ was slain. When God's great mind settles on one thing, it's a finished product. When God said, let there be, it's already finished. It had taken 100 billion years to run out. It's already finished. As soon as he said it. And when the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world, the same Bible, the same Spirit wrote and said, our names were put in the Lamb's book of life before the foundation of the world.
Amen.
So the man that wrote the song, there's a new name written down in glory. He had good meanings, but he was unscriptural. See, that name was wrote down in glory when before the world ever began, when the Lamb was slain, our names were put on the Lamb's book of life. Let me just get you one little scripture. Will you hold on just 1 minute? This comes in my mind. I think I can turn right to it. I'm not sure. And I'm sorry to keep you this long, but I told you it'd be midnight. It ain't quite that bad, but I'd just like to get this just one scripture to turn with me now to the book of Romans. And I want you to read this with me. Now, let's see, Romans, if I can find it just about right here. Now, let's get Romans 8 and let's start 28th verse of the 8th chapter of Romans. And I want you to just read it. Prayerfully with me now. Listen here. This is what God said now. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose, for whom He did foreknow. Can you read with me? For whom He did foreknow, He also did predestinate. All right? To be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called, and whom He called, them He also justified, and whom He justified, them He also glorified. From the foundation of the world, when God looked down, now God don't run His office and say, well, I'm going to, oh, what are we going to do now? See, there is nothing, remember, unrighteousness, sin is righteousness perverted. The devil cannot create. Does everyone all understand that? That's the doctrine of this church.
The devil cannot create. He can pervert what God has created.
Yes.
Now, what is perversion? Here. You all look like adults, mostly. Listen to this. We're married people. You married man and you married women can live together as husband and wife, and them women are just the same as they never were. They're virgins. As long as you stay with your husband. Right. Now, that's legal and lawful, and it's all right. It's ordained of God to do so. Another woman can do the same act of your wife. One of them, you're righteous in the sight of God. In the same act to another woman, you're condemned before God to death. What is it? Righteousness perverted. See? Righteousness perverted. Now, the devil cannot create, but he perverts what God has already created. What is a lie is the truth perverted. Somebody said, oh, it was Saturday night, 9 o'clock. Yep. Bill Branham was in Jeffersonville, correct? Down at Anson's Saloon drunk. A lie. What was it? I was in Jeffersonville, that's true. It was a righteousness perverted to a lie. See what I mean? See? A lie perverts righteousness. It's something you told where I was at. Now, if you said at the church preaching, correct, that's righteousness. You told the truth. At the tavern drinking, a lie perverted. See? Truth perverted. See what I mean? All unrighteousness is righteousness perverted. Death, what is it? Life perverted. Sickness, health perverted. You're supposed to be a good, strong man. All right? If you're sickly, what is it? Your health been perverted. See? That's all there is to it. What is it? You used to be young, beautiful women and strong, beautiful man. Now you're wrinkling, getting old. What is it? Life perverted.
Yeah.
See? Coming right back around again. See? And it has to come back. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God has promised to bring it back.
You're
just as sure as it is, we know it's here. So just as sure as it is, God's going to bring it again. He promised and has sworn He'd do it. That's what gives us. Now, what kind of people ought we to be? Now, notice how these things take place. Now, those who He foreknew, He called. Those who He called, He justified. Those, when? Before the foundation of the world. Before the world ever began. Now, if we could take this scripture and really justify it, we'd take hours on it. But we don't want to do that. But all this unrighteousness here is righteousness perverted to unrighteousness. That's what the devil does. Now, when you come to the age of accountability, and you know what's wrong and right, you're supposed to turn from your wrong because you're born in sin, shaped in iniquity, come to the world speaking lies. That you're actually born as a sexual desire, and then you must be born again in order to receive a new birth to enter into heaven, because this kind of a birth you have here, you see, where the Jehovah Witness would be so far wrong there to think that the new birth is a resurrection of the body. You see, it couldn't be. See, it's got to be something, you're in a time space, and the only thing that's eternal is something that had no beginning or no end. Anything eternal never had a beginning or it never will have an end. See? So if you're a part of God, the Spirit that's in you never had a beginning or it never will have an end. And you're eternal with the Spirit that's in you. See? Like the agapo love. Then it comes down to filial love. And then down to lust love. It just keeps going on down and on down, perverting on down. Till it becomes a just conglomeration of what? Mess. Well, the only way Jesus came down that same ladder down here to pick up and take back again to the highest form from the lowest form. From death unto life. From sickness unto health. From unrighteousness to righteousness. See? He became from the highest to the lowest that He might bring the lowest to the highest. He became me that I might through His grace become Him. An heir of the throne. In glory. See what I mean? Those things. Now look. Way back, before this world started and them Adams back under, when God seen what was going to take place, right there, He saw you, He saw me, He saw every flea, every fly, every frog, every gnat, everything that ever be on the earth, He saw it right then. Sure He did.
Now, he never said, I'll send my son down and let him die, and maybe somebody will have pity on him, and it'll be such a pitiful case that perhaps maybe somebody might get saved. He foreknew who would be saved. Yes, sir. He said, Esau, I hate, and Jacob, I love before either one ever had a chance to prove what they was, because he knew what they was. He knew. He knows everything. He knew what you'd do before you was born or when the world began. Now, look. As you know, I'm a rifleman. I like rifles. And some woman in Texas, I believe it's Texas, bought me a Swift. A 220 Swift, I always wanted one, I want to investigate it. It's the most powerful shooting little gun. It's a 22 bullet, 48 grain bullet. And you can hand load that. Now, the factory says don't do it. It's too dangerous. But you can hand load that bullet to 5,000 feet per second and still hold it in its place. 5,000 feet per second. That's a mile a second. In other words, a hawk sitting at 200 yards, you shoot the hawk, you see the feathers fly before the gun ever kick you. See? But you take the flat part of a toothpick and get into your powder and pour that much more in there, just enough that you can hold on a toothpick, and you shoot at a ground hawk sitting at the end of this building here, and he just sit and look at you. What's the matter? The bullet disintegrates. It's going so fast, and you can put a sheet between here and there, and you'll never even see one little fossil fall on the sheet. It just turns back not to ashes, volcanic ashes, but it goes farther than that. It goes back to the original acids that makes copper and lead that's in there. It goes back like it was 100 billion years ago. Now here is a little bullet, 48 grains of bullet I'm holding in my hand, and the next second it's turned back to what it was 100 million years ago. And if the world would probably stand another 100 million years, it would be back a bullet again. Could be brought right back. For you form right into copper. Now look what God did, and then you'll love him, and you go home, and in the morning you sleep a little late, and you'll love him more than ever. Now, God is a contractor. How many know that? He's a builder. All right, listen real close. Now, God back kind of, they say, now we're going to take the chronologist idea of it. God, 100 billion years ago, when he was going to make the world, well, and he just started, and he got an idea in his mind. Now, you're going to say, if he's that great, Brother Branham, how did he ever permit the devil to make sin? Well, he knew before the devil was ever created that he would be the devil. Amen. Glory! Now, if you're religious. Oh, my. He knew before the devil was created that he would be the devil. Amen. Now, you got to talk about that. You say, why did he let him be the devil? That he might be proven to be God. That's right, it is. Why was there ever unrighteous? Which was first, a Savior or a sinner? Which was first, a Savior? Which was first, a healer or a sick person? Why was there permitted to be a sinner? Because the attributes of him is a Savior. If he had never been a sinner, he had never been known as a Savior. Hallelujah! He can make all things wind around to his glory. Can the potter say to thee, or can the pot say to the potter, you made me thus? Who's on the wheel? Who's got the clay? Whose hands is it in? Paul said, oh, foolish man, didn't he say he raised Pharaoh up for this very purpose? Certainly he knew it before there was a world. He knew who it would be what. And he let there be sin that he might be a Savior. He let there be sickness that he might be a healer. He let there be hate that he might be love. Sure he did. God, and that's his attributes, and he has to have something to display his attributes. How would you ever know there was a night? How would you ever know there's any, if it's all daylight, how would you ever know there was night? There's a night, so it's approved daylight. Sure there is. Amen. You see what he did? But when he was back together before the foundation of the world, before he took this old sun and he moved it around this old star that we're living on now, this earth, and he molded over here to the sun and laid it around the sun, say, here's the sun. He molded it on this side and let her hang there for 100 billion years. What was he making? Some gases. He moved around on this side and made something else. What was he making there? Some potash. He moved around this way, and what was he doing here? Making some calcium. What was he doing? He was making you and me. Amen. What was he doing? Like the contractor. Laying out all of his two befores, his two bays, his sheeting, his siding. He knows just how many buildings he was going to build.
We're made out of 16 elements of the earth, and he has made this all and laid us out there before the world ever come into. And he might have been oblong at that time. I don't know what it was. What was he making gold and copper and brass and water all those stuff for? He's a contractor. He's made as a builder. He's laying everything out there, had everything cut and fashioned. When he got it all made, it's just a great big volcanic eruption. He let them old volcanic sprue up there for 100 million years to make some calcium. What is this? Part of you. And then before there was one speck of life on this earth, our bodies were laying here. Hallelujah. Before one drop of moisture ever come on the earth, we were laying here. When Adam walked up and down the gardens of Eden, I was laying here. Yes, sir. Oh, glory. When the cherubim, the morning stars came together and the sons of God shouted in joy, I was laying here. Just waiting for the breath of life to come. I was here. He made me here. Have a body laying here. Yes, sir. It wasn't where did it come from. Huh? How did it get here? God had it laying here. God made it. We're made out of 16 elements. Petroleum, potash, and cosmic light, and what more? See, we were laying here. Then what happened? Then God said to the Holy Ghost, we're just taking symbol for him. Now you go forth and you go to making love to that world. Because I'm love and you're a product of me, so now you go make love to the world. The big Holy Ghost, we think, come out there just in picture form. Now it wasn't that way. Of course, the Holy Ghost and God, the self-same purpose, same person. And he'll say he throwed his wings around the earth. He began to brooding. What's that brooding? Like the hen to her chickens cooing, making love. Cluck, cluck, cluck. Oh, life. Come forth! He screamed. He looked around. I want beauty on this earth. Come forth, life! The Holy Ghost is moving. When he did, I look coming, creaking down the hill down there. Here comes some calcium pouring down. It mixes with potash. What's it folding into? Life! Come forth! And a little Easter fire stuck his head up under a rock. Come here, Father, look at that. That looks good. Just keep on brooding. He brewed out the flowers. He brought out all the vegetation. He brought out the animal life. Birds flew out of the dust. After a while, up come a man and woman. Up come a man. And the man was both man and woman. Not hermaphrodite now. Just in him, there was a feminine spirit. When you take a man that's so sissified, he may be all right, balanced up all right, but there's something wrong. And when you take a woman, wants to chop her hair and wrap her over her hose and get out there, what's going on, I tell you? There's something wrong. A woman has the feminine spirit and a man is masculine. We know that. Hey, you know that. Does a woman look right, tries to be, act like a man? Well, I sat one time, I was game warden here, and I sat on the bus and went up there and was smacking that woman on the leg with my hand talking to her, and I didn't know it was a woman. She had on one of these welder's caps, a big pair of goggles like that, and I was sitting right back there, and she was telling something to her about something done. She said, you know, and she said, and last night, just as rough looking as she'd be smoking a cigarette, she said, last night, I tell you, that fella slipped up on top of that thing. He said, he come sliding down through there. I said, I never laughed so much in my life. And I was like, oh, God, boy, that was one of them. Is that a talk like that? And if she didn't take that thing off and shake her head, and she had a mop up there, that she was a woman. I never felt so little in my life. I said, are you a woman? She said, boy, sure. I said, pardon me. I never seen such. Now, that's the truth. I seen a sign in the day like to thrill me. It had a big sign up that said, ladies, ready to wear clothes. I thought, praise God for that. But come to find out, it's just some kind of a clothes they're already made. You know, I thought they're really going to put on clothes. I really did. It said, ladies are ready to wear clothes. I thought, praise God for them. That's good. I sure thank the Lord for that. But see, it's just some kind of clothes they're already made. Something had to be something funny with it in this country. All right. Then when Adam come up, and then Adam looked lonesome, so he taken a rib from his side and made Eve, a byproduct for him. He taken the feminine spirit out of Adam and put it in the woman, the love spirit, feminine, kind, gentle, and he left the masculine spirit in Adam. Now, if he's anything different, there's a perversion somewhere. Now, and then they too was one. And so let's just take a little drama, Nanny, before we close. Here it's Adam takes Eve by the arm and they walk out. I just love this story. And they walk out, you know, and Eve said, "Oh, darling, you mean you have..." "Yes, I named that." "Well, what do you call that?" "That's called horse." "Mm-hmm. What's that?" "That's cow." "Mm-hmm. You named that?" "Yeah." "Mm-hmm. What do you call that?" "Them two sitting there with their heads together. That's lovebirds." "Oh, I see." "And they're going like that." "What's this over here?" "I call that that and this shirt." "And, oh, I see. That's beautiful." "And a lion roars." "What do you call that?" "That's the lion." "What's this?" "A tiger." "And all like, oh, I see." Just like kittens, you know, meowing around. So after a while, she looks around. She said, "Darling, look at there. The sun's going down. It's time to go to church." You know, there's just something about when the sun sets, you want to worship. If you don't go to church that night, you like to get in the room, read the Bible. How many like to do that? Get out for yourself. See? It's just in a man to do that. You should do that. Time to go to church. Now, they done said, "Now, wait a minute. Now Jones belongs to the Assemblies, and we belong to the..." No, it wasn't nothing like that then. So they just went up. They didn't have a church, good seat to sit on, like that. They just went up under the great big cathedral of the woods and knelt down, and that halo was hanging down under the bushes. See? I hear a voice speak down and say, "Has my children enjoyed themselves upon the earth today that the Lord thy God has given thee?" "Yea, Lord, we've enjoyed ourselves today. Haven't we, darling?" "Yes. Yes, dear, we have. Lord, we shall appreciate you. Now I lay me down to sleep." See? And he lays his big arm out, and she lays down on his arm, and he lays the tiger down, and the lion down, and everything down to sleep. So peaceful. So God comes down and he brings down all bunch of angels. Gabriel is a creation of heaven. So they come down and they tiptoe real easy into the bedroom. See? Look around. Gabriel said, "Come here, Father. Come here. Look here. Here he is. Here lays your children laying here." How many in here ever went to the bedside, some of you mothers, you and Dad together, and looked at the little boy, the little girl, and you just remind one another, don't he look like you this way and that way? Did you ever do that? Well, many times I go and say to Meadie, say to about Joseph, she'll say, "Billy's got a high forehead like you." "Yeah. But Meadie's got big eyes like you." "Why?" "He's a part of our product of our union." Now, and a father said, can say this about this, said, "You know," Aunt Gabriel said, "you know he looks just like you." "That's how God looks. Look at yourself. That's how God looks. He looks like you. You're his offspring." How many knows that? See? Now watch. What's the lowest form of life we have? Frog. What's the highest form of life? Human. Certainly. And what is the highest form? It just kept coming from the lowest. On up. From a frog to this and to that and to the bird and to all so forth. There's higher forms of life until it comes to the highest form it could come. Then it was made in the image of God. There you are. And the woman was not made in the image of God, but in the image of man. See? Now there they are. And God looks at him and said, "Yes, they look lovely." What was that, brother? They never had to die. That was just the first handful of calcium, the first potash, and everything started off like that. Isn't it beautiful? But sin come along and marred the picture. Now, what did he permit it to be, like we talked about a while ago? He permitted it so that he could prove that he was a Savior. He did it. He let sickness happen so he could prove that he was a healer. He let death happen to prove that he was life. See? He let all these bad things happen to prove that he was good, what he was. You talk about singing the redemption stories? Why, brother, when Jesus comes, this church will stand out on the rims of this earth and sing stories of redemption when angels will bow their head not knowing what we're talking about. Well, they never was lost. They don't know what we went through. We know what it means to be lost and be found. Oh, can we scream his praises? He's not a savior to them. They never need any saving. He wasn't a healer to them. No, glory. He isn't life to them. Certainly not. They don't want dead in sin and trespasses. We were and we've been made alive. There we are. What will we say? With our crowns off, you're a reverend son? No. All glory to him. There you are. Then we'll tell the story how we overcome. We'll understand it better by and by. There in that there. Then what happened? Did God then just say, "Well, I might as well just simply destroy all my potash and calcium. It's all ruined. No, no. He knew it was going to be that way. Now, if the Holy Spirit made me what I am, and I eat food and got back in my body and build up to what I am now, I was made and formed. Every picture that God saw before the foundation of the world materialized. See? It come forth out of the woman, as he said it would. The next time it comes forth from God, it come that time by woman, it comes this time by man. See? Comes that time by a sexual desire, comes this time by a spoken word of God. See? And now, can anything harm me? No, sir. There isn't nothing can harm us. Paul said it's neither in things present, things come, sickness, death. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ. There isn't a thing can separate us. As I've told a little story, I'm just about five hairs of being bald-headed completely. And I was combing those few here some time ago. My wife said, Billy, you're almost bald-headed. I said, but I haven't lost the one of them. She said, where are they at? I said, where was before I got them? Wherever where they was before I got them. Now, there was one time, 100 years ago, these hairs wasn't here at all. But they were out here in the dust. Is that right? Then about 50 years ago, they began to come on my head. They come from where? Out of the dust. And now they're returning back to where they was. Is that right? They was not, then they were, and now they are not. What is it? What made them what they are? God! There he is! He painted a picture! So that's the way I want him. Oh, death, where is your stain? Grave, where is your victory? You may bury me one of these days from here. I don't know, but brother, I'll not be dead. I'll tell you that. No, sir. Oh, we shall rise. Hallelujah, we shall rise. On that resurrection morning, when death bars are broken, we shall rise. Hallelujah, we shall rise. There's nothing can keep me from rising. Neither the devil nor hell to keep me from rising. The enemy, nothing nowhere to keep me from rising. I have the promise of God. I have the Holy Spirit. I got Zoe, God's eternal life, resting in here. This old carcass come from there, and God brewed me out of the ground. And if he who brewed me out of the ground, when I become of age, every time I hear a church bell, something would speak to me. A little bitty boy, an angel spoke from the bush, said, don't you ever drink or smoke? I got a work for you to do. Don't defile your body to run around with women and things. You, I got something for you to do and get older. Who are you? Who are you? You'll know more about that later. After a while, here he comes. He hangs down at the baptism. He shows himself. He declares himself. He answers, I've seen standing out everywhere on every hand. How are you going to? If he made me what I am without having any choice at all? I never went back there and said, now, Charlie Brennan, you marry Ellie Harvey and bring forth me out of the earth. No, sir. I never had no choice of that. God did that. And if he made me what I am without a choice, how much more when that Holy Ghost goes to brooding over me and I say, yeah, Lord, you're my creator. I love you and I accept you as my Savior. How are you going to hold me in the dust? Just can't do it, brother. Just can't do it. God never formed one piece of this calcium or potash or anything else that ever be wasted. All the Father has given me before the foundation of the world will come to me. Woo! I feel like shouting on a sudden. All the Father has given me will come to me, and none of it shall be lost, but I'll raise it up again in the resurrection. I heard him call, and I come to him. How can they keep me in the dust of the earth? Enough undertakers in the world to pat me in the face with a shovel, but to ever keep me in the dust of the earth. I shall rise someday and stand in his likeness, washed in his blood, born of his spirit. Hallelujah. Add all the denominations you want to, I'll take Jesus. Amen. The insurance man come to me, Wilmer Snyder, a good friend of mine, he said, Billy, I want to sell you an insurance policy. I said, I already got it. My wife looked around and said, what are you lying for, boy? Said, you got insurance? I said, yes, sir. So what company is it with? What is it? I said, blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Else salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. He said, that's good, Billy, but it won't put you in a graveyard. I said, it'll get me out. Hallelujah. I ain't worried about getting there. It's getting out. So I've got the insurance that tells me I bring it. All the Father has given me, I don't care what my daddy done, what my mama done, what anything was, all the Father gives me will come to me. And no man can come unless my Father draws him. Hallelujah! Why are you going for a foreknowing before the foundation of the world? When I slayed the Lamb, I slayed him with him. Amen. Amen. I predestinated the church. What's got predestination? The church. How do you get the church? By one Spirit. We're all baptized into one body.
Amen.
He knew before the foundation of the world that we would be there. And those who He foreknew, He has called. Those who He has called, He has justified. Those who He has justified, He's already glorified.
Amen.
God's books, He done said, you'll meet me right there. Indeed, all devils out of hell can ever keep them anywhere else, but keep them from coming right there. Because God has already said so, and that settles it. If 100 billion years before the world was ever formed, the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy before there was a foundation of the world. See, before there was a foundation, and then angels and everything was happy shouting about it before there was a foundation of the world, how is the devil ever going to keep me in the dust here? Just can't
praise
do it.
The Lord.
You're right.
Praise the Lord.
Let's see, now this is Democrat time I got over here. This is 20 minutes to 11, that's only 20 minutes to 10. Is that right, Brother Woods? That's right, 20 minutes to 10. Everybody happy? Oh, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair, and I feel like traveling on. Oh, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling. Them old songs like that. It used to be an old one we used to sing about something about grace and mercy found me there the morning star showed. What is that, Sister Gertie? Let's see. What is it, Brother Neville? See, something, grace and mercy found me there the bright morning star showed its glands around me. Yeah, in the cross. Give us the chord, Sister Gertie. That's near the cross. Come up here. How many like some old inspired song? You can have all your jump up and down boogie woogie, it won't give me this. Here's where grace and mercy found me. That's it. Tonight. Do you love Him? Oh, my.
Don't forget services in the morning now at 9:30. How many knows it? Room, room, yes, there is room. Room at the fountain. When you do it now, real quietly, just reach over to the side of you and shake hands with that brother. You know, there's room now for all Methodists. There's room for Baptists. There's room for the Pentecost. There's room for all of us now at the fountain. How many knows the old song? Oh, sure you do. Some of you old-timers now, this is a good old Kentucky song now. In one of the rooms, and the literature, the latest sermons, and some of the nice writings that went forth originally in new books, new editions, will all be set up in the end of the building this next Wednesday night. And we're expecting a good time in the Lord. Come praying now. Now, call your sick and afflicted, write them a letter, get them in here. God will just move mightily. And we know that He'll do it now. And now, I've went to everybody that I know of, have little something. If there's anything out of the way now, you remember I told you a long time ago, we was going to get it straightened up. And I know that you know there's a different spirit here than what there was. That's right. And don't let it leave no more. I charge you before Jesus Christ. Don't let it leave. Stay right here with it. See? Just keep everything ironed right down and move right on. You are brethren. It's never your brother or sister that does anything wrong. It's that spirit of the devil gets in there. See, he goes, and you feel sorry for the brother or the sister, and know it's Satan to get in between. If you have some feeling about it, you get that out of you right quick, you see, because it'll canker you. Yes, it will. So stay away from it. Just remember, there's room, plenty of room. There's room for the Methodists, room for the Baptists. Remembers our old dismissing song, man. Take the name of Jesus with you. Child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it everywhere you go. Wish you stay with us, Brother Jeffries, and you, Sister Jeffries, and the boys there and on. And then at the name of Jesus, bowing, falling prostrate at His feet. Oh, my. King of kings in the heaven of crowning when our journey is complete. Take the name of Jesus with you. Take it as a shield today. Oh, when temptation draws near, breathe that holy name in prayer. Oh, I love that. That wonderful name of Jesus. Now, let's stand up right now while we sing now. All right.
Take the name of Jesus with you.
different now. Let's just bow our head down real quietly. Let's raise up one hand and say, at the name of Jesus, bow we fall, prostrate at His feet. King of kings and heaven will crown. Say,